we've taken their good idea and made it even better this morning. More importantly, the credit who goes to an individual goes to our friend and colleague, Buddy Weedman, right there in the back. I had barely, yes, let's give Buddy a hand. I had barely arrived on campus in late spring when Buddy approached me with his vision of what a technology teaching day could look like here at Gaylord College. And so he spent the rest of the spring and the summer lining up the guest speakers and panelists we have on the platform here this morning for you. So he's the guy that got us to this point, and credit, like I said, much of it, if not all of it, goes to him. So thanks again to Buddy. Of course, none of this really happens, or at least it makes it more difficult to happen, if we don't have leadership at the very top of this university. And obviously, with leadership for things like this, we need resources. And I guess the best example of use of resources was this week when Buddy and Erin Yarbrough and others rolled out some 600 or so iPads to our students. Well, more than half of the students in Gaylord College got iPads this week to access digital content for their classes. So we made good use of the resources, but again, without the initiatives and the leadership at the top coming from Evans Hall, these things are not possible. And the man who is leading the leading these initiatives is the man I'm about to introduce. And whether it be Janix, the interactive learning community, or the much bigger umbrella of One University, which enhances learning here on the OU campus and well beyond, as well as driving down costs for our students, our provost has been front and center in all these initiatives to lead OU into an exciting future. And as the chief academic officer of the state's flagship university, he might be the busiest man in Oklahoma this week with the start of the fall semester. So we're really glad to have a bit of his time here this morning. Please help me give a Gaylord College welcome to our provost, Dr. Kyle Harper. Kyle?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dean Kelley. Thank you to everyone who's put together this wonderful program today. I'm very excited to see these kinds of conversations happening on our campus. And thanks most of all to all of you who have come to this and are willing to give up your time on a Friday morning. I see that the title of my talk is Brief Remarks. So I will, it's exciting, I know. So I will keep this brief. But I just wanted to briefly reflect on why we're here. And it's something I do a lot, whether we're deciding how to invest resources, how to invest time. We need to know what the purpose is. And I talk a lot about the four fundamental or ultimate purposes of what we're doing. And one is student success, two is faculty impact, three is community impact, and four is the brand value of the university. And everything really needs to come back to one of those four ultimate purposes of the university. And the purpose of this teaching really speaks in different ways to all of those. This is about student success. And I still teach every semester. I love teaching, I love being in the classroom. And one of the reasons why I think it's important to be in the classroom constantly is that students change. It has just amazed me how much students change. Every 2 or 3 years, they come into the classroom with different expectations, different experiences of the world, different beliefs, different frames of reference, but also different expectations about media, about technology, about the kinds of tools that they're going to learn with and that you're going to use. I was just walking past one of my student workers in the provost office yesterday, and he had an app up, and I kind of leaned over his shoulder, and he didn't know I was going to do this, but what are you doing? This is called My Homework App. It's this free app, and I plug in all of my classes, and it tells me every time I got to do something. And that's the way our students live. They expect technology to help them do everything. And so it's fun, but also rewarding to try and keep up with them and to meet their expectations and to challenge them. And it's been hard for me. I'm a Roman historian, which is not the most famously progressive discipline in terms of its use of technology and media. But even a dinosaur like me has tried to adopt. But one of the lessons that I want to offer you for very personal experience, because I'm not a natural native technologist, is that it takes a lot of help. And the things that we can accomplish, we'll accomplish together. And having an environment of a college, of colleagues, that learn from each other. Having a university that supports innovation, that supports people who want to try something different. Having a university that puts tools in the hands of creative people is the only way we're going to get there. And so I certainly personally some days couldn't figure out how to log into D2L, but certainly couldn't do some of the more fun things that I've been able to do in my classroom without the help of people like at the Center for Teaching Excellence, like at Web Communications. So you have people around you, you have resources around you to help you. And so call on them, use them. They love it when they get to help faculty. So this is about student success. It's about finding ways to be creative. I think we want that to be our culture. We have a culture that rewards and values people who are willing to try things and try things differently. And it should be about faculty impact. Ultimately, this is about empowering faculty, making sure that our faculty have the tools and support that they need to be the best that they can be. And I think sometimes we think about, this is just natural to our discipline, we think about research as sort of where we continually can do better, and the research part of our career progresses. You publish the next big article or book or get the next award or fellowship. But I think it's important to think of your teaching side of your career like that too, and certainly I've found this rewarding to try and become a better teacher. And to think of that too as a part of a career that develops over time. And every semester I try and do something a little bit different or a little bit better. It not only keeps it more fun and fresh for me, but I think it's fulfilling in the same way that the progress in a research career is fulfilling. So using technology certainly is one way that we can develop as teachers. It's not the only way, but it's a set of tools that we can bring with us. So student success, faculty impact, community impact, and finally brand value. I'm so glad to see Dipankar here because the EEMBA, the success of that story is one that I think has a lot of lessons for all of us around the university. So I've heard this talk before. I wish everybody could hear it. It's a very smart, very important lesson about what's possible when we're willing to step out and try and be creative and try and realize the potential of the OU brand. We have a lot of special things going for us at the university, and so as the people in this college know very, very well, it's important for us to project that brand, to be out in the world, and to be making a difference. So that's what today's about. I'm very grateful for everybody that put it together and everybody who's here willing to learn. So thank you for your time. Have a wonderful and rich and rewarding day, and I hope that creative ideas come out of today, that this isn't just a one-way set of information dump, but instead that it's very much a conversation, and that everyone presenting and everyone in the audience has sparks of new creativity come out of the conversations today. So always be creative, always be innovating. I hope today stirs that creative energy. Have a good afternoon, or good morning.
Cal, thanks so much. A perfect way to kick this off. And we're going to kick it off with a panelist of people you're going to recognize, our fellow folks at Gaylord College, Adam Croom, Robert Kerr, David Tarpenning, and Ralph Beliveau. Ralph will be the one who will be moderating the panel. It's all yours.
Thank you. Good morning. This is really weird. It's weird because I have my tool suit on, as my daughter calls it. And also because I know you all so well, so thank you for taking the time to be here. I wanted to frame just a couple of little ideas and then go to people who actually know what they're talking about. I'd like to say personally thank you to the support that we've been given from Mark Morvant, the Center for Teaching Excellence, from Keegan, who's been interacting with a lot of our students and our faculty, and they're offering us some wonderful resources and support for what we're trying to do. In terms of what we're trying to do, what I'm interested in, and this I'm interested in this both as a teacher and a scholar and just a person who loves media, is the idea of multiliteracies and integrating theory and practice. Those are the two things that I just want to say something really briefly about before we get to the panel. Partially because the idea is when we start using technology, we start becoming a little obsessed with teaching the technology and we forget what the learning objectives are underneath. And that's really what should be driving what we're doing is the learning objectives. Stuart Selber, who wrote a book called Multiliteracies in the Digital Age, defines multiliteracies in three categories. Functional, where you think of technology as tools so that our students are learning skills that allow them to be successful in the world, or possible producers if they're entrepreneurial. Then critical approaches to multiliteracies, where you think of technology as cultural artifacts, where students question technologies and incorporate their identity into what's going on. And then rhetorical, where you start thinking of technology as hypertextual media, where students are producers and they use the tools to talk back to the world of what we know and add to it. And that's where I think this becomes extremely interesting, is what can we do with these tools so that we're enabling students to continue to learn, because that's going to keep happening, and you know, to eventually talk back into the world. And as we interact with them, we trade positions as students and teachers, that eventually I know what I get most excited about in classes is when somebody's teaching me something I don't know. And I know students learn better when they're in the position of having to teach something to somebody else. So I see those as very much interchanging places. And so I think with the examples we'll hear from the people who are on the panel today, one of the things we'll hear about are, it's kind of a different model, because the other thing that it instantiates is the idea that you can try ideas and they can fail. And instead of feeling embarrassed and pretending they didn't happen, you learn from the failures. You build on them. You go, oh, okay, I tried that. It didn't work. This is why. Now I can try something else. And even a continual pattern of frustrations and failures like that, if you keep it in the right frame of mind, the mindset stuff that Ryan Bissell will be doing this semester, it can be as transformative as success. And in fact, I think sometimes more helpful, because you can be more reflexive when something doesn't work the way you think it's going to. So given all that, we'll hear about the experiments that have been going on in some of our classrooms that have been conducted by these three people as teachers in the Gaylord College, who you already know and have been introduced to. Part of my responsibility is to sort of unceremoniously tell them to shut up after 10 minutes, but I'll be polite about it, but to make sure that we move through, and then we'll have some time to talk afterwards. So we'll be hearing from David Tarpenning, who's on your right, you all know this, Robert Kerr, and Adam Croom. Would one of you like to start?
Yes.
All right, Robert's going to start.
Yes, I've already drawn the short straw. So. yes, hello, I'm Robert Kerr. I think most of you know me, but I just want to say first that I regret that I didn't check with the provost about the dress code today. I was talking to Brooks Brothers Tarpenning here yesterday, and I knew he would look like this, and I said, well...
Really?
I said, well, I can't wear my usual T-shirt and shorts, so I'm going to have to try. But if I had known the provost was going to show up in, you know, shirt sleeves and topsiders, I, but I do want to echo what he said and what Professor Beliveau said. I think this very much is a place just to get ideas. The last few years, as I've gotten into this, sometimes people would hear about, you know, oh, Kerr's teaching online, and they would ask me, okay, how do you do that? And I've always resisted that kind of conversation, at least on my part, as if I could tell people. Because I think the great thing is that this age we live in, it's opened up, you know, a lot of good, a lot that's not so good, but it's just endless ways to teach now in this new cyber classroom. So, you know, I that's what I would say, too, is I hope there are sparks and ideas that come out of this today. And I really am... here even more, I would be fine if I didn't have to talk, because to be up here on this panel, if you don't know this, I was here summer before last when Professor Tarpenning was up here all summer, just dramatically transforming our intro media class. I mean, he's done things that I haven't even come close to yet, and from what it was 2 years ago to now, for David to take this on after teaching for so many years, I still always love to talk to him. And then when I turn and look at Adam, who was in my class a few years ago, and now, you know, yeah. I think about in 1974, a writer for Rolling Stone went to a little club in New Jersey, and then he wrote in the next issue, he said, I have seen the future of rock and roll, and its name is Bruce Springsteen. That was a very famous line, and it turned out to be true. Bruce Springsteen became very, you know, huge, immense. And actually, I don't want to embarrass you, Adam, but when I look at Adam today and I see what he's doing, and I try to think about what is the future of digital education, I think it looks something like Adam Croom. So we're really lucky. my students know I tend to like to, you know, personalize and connect before I get to the material. But I would say, as far as anything I say today, I teach large concept classes, and more of the classes in Gaylord are small skills classes. So I don't know that what I've done would be directly applicable to the skills classes, but I'm seeing there are people who are teaching skills classes online, and apparently in some cases doing it very successfully, including Adam, which I'm sure he's going to talk about the PR publications class. But for many reasons, some administrative, some from hearing things the provost has been saying the last few years, some that I've heard from other administrators, and things that I've heard from students, a lot from students, I began experimenting with online components in my classes. I didn't just go straight into an online class. I had been teaching in the classroom, including in this room, for many, many years. And I would just experiment with small online components in those traditional classes. And then gradually, after a year or so, began doing more of a blended hybrid kind of version where you do some things in classes, but then you have work online and you try to synthesize the two, make them work together. And then this summer, for the first time, I developed our first ever fully online version of Mass Comm Law. And it turned out it was very popular. It was very well received. 32 students ended up signing up for the course, which I understand is pretty large for a summer course. And the odd thing was, I thought some of them would wind up wanting to come see me and talk about things. I never saw one of them. We exchanged a lot of emails, which is definitely something you need to plan on if you're going to teach an online class. Plan on doing more email or texting if you're comfortable with that, or Skype, or whatever you decide works best for your class. Along the way, I've done a lot of ongoing surveying of my students. Sometimes informal feedback, but quite a bit of formal. Not things I was trying to publish in the research that I do, just trying to maintain an ongoing dialogue, giving students a number of different questions over the time of the course. And that was even before I got to this fully online version. I would ask students in advance, what kind of things? Would this work? How would you react to this? And that's tremendously helpful, to be surveying students in an ongoing way, because when we make assumptions about where this generation is, we're quite often going to be wrong. In fact, one thing we're going to be wrong about is that in many ways they aren't going to be as up to speed on certain technologies as we might assume they are. If you get into this, you're probably going to have to do a certain amount of education on the technology itself to make sure they're up to speed, because today's students, just speaking generally, they do understand the things they like to do very well, social media, but specific tools can often be challenging. We did exams one semester on iPads on a software called ExamSoft, and it had a lot of great features, but one of the biggest problems was keeping the students up to speed on what they need to do to make sure ExamSoft was working on the iPads. So, like I said, as Professor Beliveau said, a lot of experiments along the way, first in the law class, later in the history class that I teach, a lot of different things. I try to keep them busy. I've tried to stick, even online, to something that approximates a Monday, Wednesday, or Tuesday, Thursday class schedule. And that students always say, well, I'm afraid I'm going to forget what I'm supposed to do. And so I tell them, well, for a Monday, Wednesday class, you come to class on Monday, Wednesday. For a Monday, Wednesday class online, at least on Monday, Wednesday, you go to D2L. And I make it very clear what they need to be doing at that point in time. And again, a bigger idea that's in a lot of the literature now is trying to advance learning by repeated engagement with the material, not letting them ever get away from Mass Comm Law or journalism, media history for too long, make their minds come back to it, even in small ways online. And that's much easier to do online. One big thing I would say is that, I don't mean to keep contrasting myself with Adam, but Adam is a digital native and I'm not. I kind of feel like I'm more like, Adam is more like those creatures coming off to the Close Encounters spaceship, and everybody's going, wow, there's the future. And I think when they look at me, they go, oh, isn't that cute? Look at that dinosaur. He's playing with digital tools, or he thinks he is. And, my thinking is still grounded in the centuries-old traditions. When I think of how do you learn something, you listen to someone or someone's who know about it. You read, you know, good material. You discuss the subject. You write about it, and then you think about all that, you know. So listen, write, discuss, read, think. And what I've tried to do is find ways to replicate those actual activities online. And I think D2L does offer a lot more ways to do that than people think. And the reason I stuck with D2L, by the way, is that in surveying students, that seemed to be the most student-friendly option. And I know a lot of people have a lot of problems with D2L. I do too sometimes. I had some big ones this summer. But I was here when we had Blackboard, and people hated Blackboard. And so we went through a big transition to D2L, and now we're talking about maybe something else. I will bet you if we go to something else, there will be just as many complaints about whatever we go to. But the students are comfortable with D2L by and large. D2L will work with you to, if something isn't working, to get it working. And you can do a lot of different things. You know, you can make assignments. You can post podcasts. You can link to readings. You can have some pretty good discussions. I really think I'm having better discussions than I ever had in the classroom, partly because I teach large classes, and it's hard to get large classes really talking. A few will talk, and the rest will, you know, get busy on Twitter or something. But in online discussions, everyone has to participate. And that's one particular area that I think online has an advantage. It doesn't always have those advantages. I will mention one other trade-off, and students brought this to my attention. In an actual classroom, you know, if you have a question, you can raise your hand, and the professor sees you, they'll call on you and you know, try to answer your question right then. You can't do that in most online venues, but what you can do, and again, students alerted me to this, and I realized, you know, this is a powerful dynamic. Students can rewind a podcast as many times as they want. And oftentimes, that's what they need. They maybe just didn't hear it when you said it the first time. They rewind, they listen to it again. Oh, okay, I get it now. And if they still don't, then they may ask a more precise question via some electronic means, you know, email or whatever. So there's a lot of trade-offs. I've tried to focus on the strengths and minimize the weaknesses as best I can. And one last thing I'll say is that in some of our discussions as a faculty, I could tell there was at least an underlying current that some people thought, well, people will just go teach online because it's easier. And I will tell you that it's almost certainly not going to be easier, especially for me, everything being new and me trying to figure out ways from translating from, you know, the olden days to digital. It's been a lot, and it still is a lot of work. I think the crucial variable, it's not whether, as far as to the amount of work, it's not whether you teach online or whether you teach in an actual classroom. I think the crucial variable is whether you try to teach well or not. Because if you try to teach well in an actual classroom, it's going to be a lot of work. And if you try to teach well online, it's going to be a lot of work. There's a lot of design that goes into it. There's a lot of ongoing interaction with the students. There's a lot of surprises, things you realize, oh, I've got to get on the right now and fix that. So I just wanted to make that point, because I think that's really true, is this is just another set of tools. It's not a watershed change. I've heard Provost Harper say that decades from now, there will still be many, many thousands of people who want to come to the brick-and-mortar OU for the actual experience of being here, but that the university needs to be in the online game. We just have to be, or we'll fall behind other universities that pick off our students and enroll them in online classes. So we need to be involved, and it gives students a lot of options, a lot of flexibility. So I'll stop there, and I don't know who's
Adam.
Next.
Ralph started off by saying this is weird. This is weirder for me because all of three of you guys were my instructors. I feel like I should take like a selfie or something and send it to my mom and say, congratulations, your investment paid off. The tables have turned. So I didn't prepare too much, but I did jot down three notes and some things that I wanted to touch on what gets me excited about digital learning. The first thing is that I genuinely believe that we're in an era where we're seeing a re-energizing in media because of digital. And I think it's something that we've really only seen in the last 2 years. our companies really start to double down on digital. But then you also see these, you've mentioned digital native, these digital native companies that have come up to be, that print's not even an option for them, whether that's Vox or some of the ESPN shoot-offs or Huffington Post or Politico, in which this is a really exciting time for media because of it. And that's something that I'm interested in myself, is how do we embed students within where media is as well. My roommate and I worked 7 of my 8 semesters at the student paper. He did as well. He worked for the LA Times and the Boston Globe, and our nightly conversations were literally, how do we save the newspaper? And he now works for ESPN.com. I never thought I'd see him leave a newspaper. Like, we were black and white, ink on our hands people, as young as we are. But that's where we're seeing media going, and it's an exciting place to be. I truly believe that we can embed our students in it, and they get a rich learning experience. I'd say the second thing, and Ralph touched on this a little bit, is I'm a really huge believer in student-centered learning. I think even the title of this, I'm going to grab this real quick, is The Benefits of and Challenges of Teaching in Digital World. And I would probably say, tweak that and say, The Benefits and Challenges of Learning in a Digital World. Because I think sometimes we compare teaching too much to instructing. And we think that learning is being instructed. And I think that we can model ways of learning in which we're not talking to someone and they're not just absorbing what we're saying, but we're really shepherding them into their own experience of building, curating, and refining their own personal learning environment. It's a lot of what I have my students do myself. And I'd say the third thing that I'm interested in, because of digital learning, is we only get students in the traditional undergraduate experience for 4, maybe 5 years, right? And there's only so much learning, and it's really stuck within a specific amount of time. And what we're seeing is you have to learn somewhere once you leave here, and a lot of times it's not something that we're facilitating ourselves. And the digital space is where people are beginning to learn. Talk to anyone who's into computer science and ask them how they are learning now. They're having to refine. We teach them the foundational knowledge of something like programming, but they're having to go online later and understand what's the newest language that I have to know. How do I learn Ruby on Rails or Jekyll or Bootstrap or whatever it is in which they're going to have to know now that didn't even exist when they were students. And I think as an institution, we can be teaching people how to understand that they have to be a lifelong learner to get it in this industry now. It's going to be something that's going to have to be required, because we're going to see, even within the next decade, I think, a reshaping of how media is. And they're going to have to learn a lot. Our job should be to teach the foundations and then teach them how to teach themselves. And I think for us, as a higher ed institution, we've always kind of defined lifelong learners as almost like as like an age cohort, right? We think the lifelong learner is the distinguished people, maybe were involved with the institution, that come back for a few lectures at an elder age to learn from us. And it's like that's actually not it. We all have to be lifelong learners now. I mean, it's something that we're gonna have to do. We've always had to do it, but I think it's much more apparent now and much more obvious. And so that's essentially, I think, what is rooted in what I wanna do in my class. I'll speak a little bit about PR publications. It's in the design sequence of the PR, design of the PR sequence, sorry. And what I have my students do, it's gone online for the first time this spring, I also taught it this summer, is that I tried to think about how I focus as least on myself as possible, least on me actually instructing, and instead giving them scenarios in which they have to essentially learn the material themselves. And what I have them do is actually narrate their learning process on a blog. I would say probably a little bit further on a blog, I'd say like an actual domain. So students actually register their name.com. They install WordPress on it, and they actually are doing weekly reflections on drafts that they're doing, on things that they're actually creating themselves. And then what I do is I actually aggregate those together through a feed in which students can see each other's works. And what I'm trying to do there is, I have my students, we go around and we say, I do this within a Google Hangout and say, okay, tell me how much you know about design. And they say, I don't know anything about design. I say, that's okay, we're all amateurs here. The best way that we're gonna learn is gonna be showing each other how we've learned this, right? We're all coming from this amateur state. And so leverage your blog to share what you're learning with each other. And they do that. They might start by being a little bit more tied to what I'm actually trying to give them in a rubric, but soon what I see is they're sharing tips and tricks with each other, and they're doing it less for themselves and even more so less for me and more for each other. And that's the environment that I'm trying to create, is that you actually have a learning environment which you own, your own domain, which is kind of tied to my philosophical idea that which you should own your own learning. That becomes the manifestation of that. You do it there. You take it with you after my class. It becomes a portfolio. But it's also a way in which we can have distributed learning on these own places that can be aggregated together and which can help hopefully the class cohort. And so that's the nuts and bolts of kind of what I'm trying to do and facilitate within my class. I'll pass it to David.
That's it. And that is my extreme thanks to Dr. Mark Morvant and his crew at CTE, and excuse me, to Erin Yarbrough, because I could never have achieved whatever I've achieved without them. Keegan is my own kind of personal advisor, personal tech advisor. Anytime I need anything, I consult Keegan. Adam has been very instrumental. They've just been wonderful. Believe me, when they told me I was going to teach Introduction to Mass Communication and they said there are going to be about 300 freshmen in there, I thought, well, the easiest way out of this is to have a nervous breakdown. And I just, excuse me, I just about did that. Oh, you can't hear? Even having them hear me in the back without a microphone. So is it okay, Julie? Okay, good, great. So anyway, when I was told I was going to teach that, I thought, well, great, I've got a summer before I have to do this, so I'm going to devote my entire summer to it. And I mentioned it to Erin, I think one time, that I would like to use iPads, not just because they were iPads, but as a tool to use in teaching the class. And I thought, when I mentioned the number 300, Erin's probably going to say, no, that's totally impossible. But she did not. She said, yes, we can do this. And so we did. We worked it out. And then the rest of that summer I spent with Keegan and Adam and Mark and Erin and her crew. Believe me, it takes a village. When you're a digital dinosaur like I am, it takes a village to put this together. And they were my village. I could never have done what I'm doing today with these classes if it hadn't been for them. Probably about 300 and some out of the 600 iPads that were distributed went to my classes, because I use extensively the iPad in my classes as a teaching tool, as a learning instrument. There are many, many reasons why I did this. In the beginning, when they started talking to me about this class, I went online and looked for some maybe answers, some ideas about what I could do. And Dr. Robert Peterson, I think, at the University of Michigan, had come out and said, okay, here's what you can do with technology. You can ban it in the classroom, and you can say, bring everything up here up front, and don't, you can come up after class and pick it up, or you can embrace it and say, okay, we're going to use technology. You can ignore it, which means somebody out there is going to be doing Facebook, and they're going to be doing Twitter while you're talking. I figured it was probably better to embrace it and to use it in the classroom and to adapt it to what I wanted to do in the classroom with 300 freshmen. As it turned out, now I use the iPad in all of my classes, and I'm going to be a little more specific than you guys were and talk about some of the tools that I use that are available on the iPad. The thing about using the iPad and using technology is it engages the student. And it allows you to move away from more specified content and into more specified learning outcomes, which I think is really important as far as the student is concerned. I use it extensively, of course, in the Intro to Mass Comm class, because at this point there are 276 students in there. And when you stand up in front of 276 students and you look at them and you think, how am I going to keep them all engaged? These kids come from a high school graduating class that's probably less than the class they're in over there in Dale Hall. The other thing we have to be concerned about is Dale Hall itself. I've threatened to take a bulldozer to it, sorry. Sometimes the technology works, sometimes it doesn't. So to avoid being frustrated, and this semester we're going to do it a little bit differently. We're going to have alternate lectures, which means I'm going to have double the content. But if the technology goes out, at least I have something that I can use. But when the technology is good, and when we can use it, it works wonderfully well. It allows me, for example, if I use Explain Everything, I'm going to talk about some of these tools that we use, some of these apps that we use. If I use Explain Everything, I can take my iPad with a Padlet, a little rubber, it's a very expensive rubber band is what it is, that allows you to hold your iPad in one hand and work on it with the other. And you can walk up and down the aisles. And another thing this does, it keeps them from getting on their laptop and doing things they shouldn't be doing, because they say, well, the teacher's right there and he's going to see what I'm doing. It allows me to, if a student has a question, I can go to the content and circle it and we can discuss it further. Some of the things we use, some of the other apps we use, for example, Today's Meet. I've discovered that in a freshman class, these kids are very reluctant to raise their hand and say anything in front of their peers. I don't understand that, because it's been a long time since I was a freshman. In fact, I can't even remember when I was a freshman. But anyway, they are allowed to use Today's Meet, so we all aggregate. It becomes an online classroom. They ask questions of the speaker on their iPad, and then we aggregate them up front, and we determine which questions are going to be asked to the speaker. I don't put them on the screen, because sometimes, as we pointed out last semester when Mike Betcher was talking, there are some inappropriate comments, which I do not want to come out on the screen. So we aggregate them from an iPad up front, and then we turn around and ask the questions to Mike. And that way, the students don't have to worry about raising their hand in front of their peers. They can just go ahead and ask the question, and we can ask Mike, and they get the answer they want. Some of the other things we use, for example, we use the iPad as a shooting instrument. There are not enough cameras around here to go around, so they actually shoot video on their iPad. They do a person on the street interviews for some of the topics, for example, invasion of privacy. We did something with Edward Snowden where they went out to talk about, traitor or patriot, to get some ideas, and then they bring those back and edit. They edit and they shoot and edit on the iPad. And it's amazing what a student who's creative, who's smart, who knows how to use technology can come back with some really, really good footage on their iPad. So it has proven to be really a terrific tool for us to use, and it's been really, really great as far as that class. They blog in that class, and then we've tried, and this semester I'm going to give it a little bit more push. They actually post the blogs on their domains, which is really, really nice. The university gives them these domains to use, and they're theirs for the entire 4 years free. And then at the end of the 4 years, they can pay $12 a year, which is minor. But it gives them a portfolio, and I stress that with these freshmen. If you start now and you put the information and the material that you're doing in this class on your domain, and then later on when you go for an interview for an internship or a job and they say, what did you do in college, you can show them. It's right there in your domain. So, whoever thought of this idea, maybe it came from Mark's group, I don't know, but it's a fantastic idea. The blogs we had last year, I uncovered some fantastic writers, and it was kind of, just a little aside, it was kind of fun because one of these guys was just a tremendous writer. He would take the subjects that I gave them for a blog, he came back with some of the most critically thought out, amazing pieces of information that I've ever seen. So I emailed him back and I said, gee, I hope you're going into Gaylord, because you're a fantastic writer. And he said, no, I'm majoring in political science. So I actually had a talk with Gerardo, and I, not Geraldo, but Gerardo, and I said, Gerardo, you're so fantastic. You really need to be a writer. You need to get into Gaylord College. So as a consequence, he's here. And I'm extremely pleased because he's a great writer. He does really, really good work. I use the iPad in all of my classes, so probably, as I said, I think I said a minute ago, 300 of the 600 that were passed out probably went to my classes. 276 went over there. I use them in, because I came late to the PR Pubs class, I didn't have a chance to do what Adam has done, but I have given them their information on the iPad along with all the creative resources they need in hyperlinks. I write an iBook for all of my classes and I put hyperlinks in it so that they can access other information. They don't have to copy and paste. They can just hit the hyperlink and get the information they need. And that really works well in some of the creative classes because the creative resources are out there. They just don't know how to find them. So I put those all in my iBooks, and then they can go ahead and just click on those links, and they have the resources they need. I think the iBook is a fantastic way to go. And there are open books, of course, online that you can use for text. You can adapt them. You can change them. You can do anything you want. You can use their material. It's open. You do sometimes it requires giving credit, but that's a lot better than having a student pay $184 for a textbook, which is what our textbook cost the first semester. And I got really bad feedback on my midterm assessments because I do a midterm assessment in the large class over there to find out what they like, what's going on, how they, you know, how they're adapting. And the one thing they did say was, we don't like the textbook. There's too much extraneous material that doesn't help us. We need something that brings it down to what we can actually assimilate. So I think Adam said you use D2L extensively, or was it Robert?
I use D2L
extensively, and I've heard a lot of people say, I don't like D2L and I'm not going to use it. You're bypassing a really great learning tool and something that really helps you, something the university has given you that's going to help in your teaching. I've talked with Keegan, and I think what we're going to, and Dr. Hong Lin really helped me design this class in the beginning of the big class over in Dale Hall. She helped me design the class, and the idea was at that time that we were going to put them in virtual groups. There would be virtual discussion groups. Keegan came up with something the other day called scannability and notability, which I would really like to try, but he's got some other solutions to it too. If I put them in virtual groups on D2L, they feel more comfortable discussing things among themselves, and then we'll aggregate that and we'll take what they've done in their discussion groups and we'll turn around and then we can discuss it with a class. I think it will work. I think it'll work a lot better. That room is, you're shoulder to shoulder in that room. I know, I remember specifically the day that Dr. Lynn and I went over there to look at the room, and she said, this is impossible. She said, they're shoulder to shoulder. There's just no way you're going to be able to teach in here. Here are my suggestions. And one of them probably should have been just abandon the class because it really is. It's tough. You cannot give a test in that room and make it fair because they can't, no matter where they put their eyes, even if they're looking straight forward and have any peripheral vision at all, they can see what's going on next to them. So it's really tough. So my quizzes are online. I think that's the fair way to do it. I don't have to worry about cheating. I don't have to worry about somebody saying, oh, you're looking on my paper, because the room is not conducive to that. But it's what we have, and so we deal with it, and we do the best we can with it. Trying to think if there's anything else. Extensive use of D2L, I've said that. I post my PowerPoint lectures and my notes on D2L because it's really convenient for them to get to them that way. And it makes it a lot easier when it comes time to study for a quiz because the notes and everything are on D2L. I think probably that's about it for me, Ralph.
Hello? There, okay. Hi, so we have some time. You want to use one of those? for questions, discussion? Ike, do you want me to come down to that, buddy, or do you want to? He looks better doing it.
So one of the things that Provost Harper talked about was how students are changing even every 2 to 3 years. What are some of the things that you have seen change in your students, even over the last year, 2 years, that have either made it more difficult for you guys or easier for you as you teach with new technologies? And maybe what are their expectations? That could be one of them.
Well, I don't know if I see them changing every 2-3 years as much as I've seen a huge change at some point between 10 years ago. And sometimes I wonder, well, am I just getting old? And old people always say, well, the young people are changing. You know, maybe that's part of it. But I really think that two big things happened in the last 10 years, and that was smartphones became widely available and inexpensive, and social media became just universally popular. And I personally strongly feel that that has changed the way, how could it not change the way people coming up today would see the world? Because they experience, I experienced most of life more in an actual world. We had a little bit of television when I was growing up, you know, 3 channels, and we had print media and radio. But still, I think mostly I was experiencing the world in a virtual way. And I had the feeling 10 years ago that that was still largely the way my students had come to, you know, conceptualize the world, is through actual experience. And now I have the feeling that students, probably the majority of their interaction with the world is through their phones. and that's very reductive, but there's so much to it. And because I began to perceive that things that I did in class didn't seem to generate the same kind of interaction and response that they had just a few years before. And I began to think, well, it seems like their minds are somewhere else. And then I would walk around behind the room while I was showing a video, and I would see their minds were all on Facebook and Twitter and, you know, whatever. Online gambling in some cases, but do that sometime. Walk around and look at the screens from the back of the room, because it's a different perception than up here on the stage. But even if you force them, force them to turn off those phones and put them away, I'm pretty sure their minds are still going to be more connected to the phone than they are to you standing on the stage, unless you really do compelling, vivid things. And so when I am in the classroom, that's what I've tried to do, is find even more vivid, interacting ways to get their minds out of the virtual world and into this world. So that's what I think.
I've only had about a year with these students last year, and then starting this year, I noticed that, of course, we use iClicker. I think I forgot to mention that. We use iClicker in the room, and we use the iClicker app so that they don't have to buy the actual clicker. They use the app, and we're going to Reef this year, and it'll be a little bit different. But I do a thing. I do a quiz at the first of every week, last week in the news, because I want them to get familiar. One of the things one of our outcomes in here is to create media literate citizens. And I think the only way to do that is to encourage, you can't force them, but you can encourage them to use the media to become an intelligent consumer of the media. So we use iClicker. And iClicker gives them the opportunity to respond, and then the responses are on the screen. So I can do my, I can show them the images, and I can give them the 5 options. What is this? And then they can go ahead and respond with their clicker, and they can see it on screen. And that is always, I think, that part of engagement, especially the first semester when I was really concerned, because these are freshmen, are they going to do anything? I think the engagement feature with iClicker and using their iPad for that particular feature every week was incredible. And I'm looking forward, I'm hoping it's going to be the same this semester, this year.
I'll just briefly say that I think a great follow-up to this discussion would actually be this panel not being us, but being students, and actually hearing a student perspective, because I don't like to paraphrase on behalf of the students. But I will say that one thing that I have seen change is, and Ralph mentioned this before, Ralph has an amazing ability to sum up everything that I would want to say in about a fifth of the time. But I would say that I've started to integrate things into my curriculum or tools that I don't even know yet, just to see the students get into them. And I will say that there's been a change in technology. My class is rooted in some like industry standard apps like Photoshop and InDesign. And you know, everything can be done, 95% of what those can be done on a smartphone now or on a tablet. And it's easier for me to just throw something in and say, hey, we're gonna try this infographic assignment. You guys tell me what you think. And the response to those has been overwhelmingly, usually really, really good. They're not having to purchase something for $20 a year for 12 months, and they're actually having the opportunity to use something that they have with them. So I would say those are things that I've been interested in seeing change.
Oh, I just add too. I think the changes do mean that when we do online instruction, most students are going to be more receptive to it. I always ask students at the end of the course in one of my last surveys, would you have rather this course had been fully in a traditional classroom? And a very, very small decreasing percentage say that they would have preferred to be in the classroom. So, and if you get it set up well, they're very comfortable and they really like the online tools. So.
Yeah, I'll add an anecdote to that. So when I first did online this last year, I decided that I would do open office hours in the creative lab. And so they could actually come to sort of what was like a classroom setting. And I was expecting to see more students. It was a very stressful week. It's a week that I call boot camp in my class. And I was expecting to see like the whole class show up and be like, we don't know what we're doing. And like two students showed up, and they had a little bit of trouble and we walked through it. And then I just kind of casually asked them, why did you take this class? And I'm hoping for kind of like an ego boost. And it was like, well, the other sections were, I just wanted to take you, and that was the only thing that was available. Your face-to-face was full. And that wasn't the answer at all. Their answer was, we like learning online. We just kind of like having one class a semester in which it helps us with our schedule. We're a college that's rooted in internships a lot, and they're working in Oklahoma City. And it's like, it's really, really helpful and flexible, and I actually enjoy this learning environment. And I'm gonna remember that the rest of my life. It was a big turning point for me for going, it's really not about me. It's not about, you're not signing up to be with me. This is something in which they just want this kind of learning environment.
Hi, it's Kathy. I have just about, it's not my question, but to bounce off what you guys said, I have a teenage daughter, as a lot of you know, and she's my own little personal research project when it comes to the technology. And we tend to think as technology is limiting them because they're not engaging with the outside real world. But what I'm seeing is they're actually more engaged with more of the world, scarily sometimes, than we ever were. And she's learning way more than I did at her age, just from being online. So, I take that kind of into account as I have new students now that they these tools actually are broadening their worldview, not narrowing it. But my question is actually pretty basic. David, you mentioned today's Meet app. Uh-huh. When I tried to find it in the app store, it didn't come up. Do I have the wrong name? You mentioned an app called Meet.
Yeah, today's Meet.
It's a web app. Oh,
sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
It will be in the App Store.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you mentioned that you give quizzes online.
Yes.
How do you prevent cheating for that, or do you not care?
No, they actually, it's kind of, in a way, I guess it's kind of a flipped class. They can use their own material, the stuff that's in the material that's in the iBook, the student packet that they have. And they just do the quiz online and submit it. Actually, it's done and submitted in Dropbox on D2L and then graded. excuse me. It's just in that particular class. Now, I'm not sure it would work in every class, but it works in there because of the room and the impossibility of having them actually take a test physically.
I just want to say, Kathy, I didn't mean to suggest that it's narrowing their perception of the world. It's transforming it.
Yes.
I think because what's here is so rich and so vivid, and there's so much that, and they've grown up there, that a person, a real person standing in front of them, has a harder time being as interesting
to, you know, exactly. to a person whose mind has been shaped that way.
We presume that students are savvy with technology, and they are as long as they're consuming, but they have to be able to produce. And what are your metacognitive approaches for you? You've got a course, you've got all this content to cover, and then you've got a new tool or a new app, or how do you, I know that Keegan has created movies about Create OU, and we have lynda.com, but what are some of your strategies to teach them how to learn with this new technology or this new environment?
So I would say a lot of my projects are scaffolded where, so just to talk about like design itself, I might have them walk through something like a lynda.com tutorial at first to kind of get the basics. And then my next assignment's gonna be like a deconstruction where I give them like a final product and I say, just recreate this. So it's a little bit, they're thinking more about what concepts go into creating something like that. And then I move to stuff that's got, it's more blank canvas, but it's got parameters around it. And I think the best you can do is not focus on learning the technology, you know, and not learning the how, but really, really focusing on the why. And the hope with that is that the how is going to translate as you move technologies more. And that's what I see when I change to some of the newer ones is, like for instance, one that I integrated this last semester is called Canva, and it's a web-based free design app. And my students really, really love it, and I'm convinced the reason they do is because they first learned on Photoshop and InDesign, and they can appreciate kind of the affordances of what the newer tools have to learn. And it's because they know the why now, and it's not really the how. So I've structured learning the how, but I've also tried to really, really wrap it around, you know, what are our basic design principles, how are you leveraging those, and how are those going to change, you know, when we shuffle out technologies.
One reason I use D2L is because they already have a certain level of familiarity. And then usually, especially at the beginning of the semester and sometimes other times as needed, I'll make really short videos just using QuickTime, sort of screen capture, showing them, you know, putting the same screen up that that they'll be seeing and then showing and me going through the steps, here's the best way to do it. And surprisingly, sometimes even simple things do trip people up because in the past on D2L, if you were in content and you needed to go to assignments and pull down and go to discussions or whatever, you had to actually go over to assignments. Now you can link directly. But in the past, a lot of people would get lost. They would say, well, where do you want us to go? You know, and they would ask me that in an email, and I'd be trying to explain. And I thought, well, I need to just make, like I said, QuickTime makes it really easy to do those little visual, your voice in the background, you know, D2L in the foreground. That's very helpful. And anytime I do something that I haven't done before, I'll put it in an email, just the very basics, go here, click there. I really try to reduce it to, you know, the first step to something really basic. And then once they're there, usually you try to have it set up so that things unfold just, you know, naturally, so instinctively. So.
I think one thing I've discovered particularly in the freshman class, is we have to add a why to the how. And we have to tell them, why are we doing this assignment? Why are we doing this particular piece of material? And it isn't just busy work. This is lending itself to making you a more literate citizen. So when I do that, and I say, this is why we're doing the assignment, this is what it's going to do for you, then the technology just becomes a tool that they're going to accomplish the how.
Yeah, and I would just quickly add that, I mentioned this earlier, but wrapping things around social, you know, and trying to write assignments in which people can learn from each other is, I think, hugely important, is that we can't underestimate the ability for them to learn together. So.
Okay, Rob can here. Once you made the change over totally to online, do you enjoy teaching as much, more, or less? And also, do you see yourself as effective as a teacher in the same way as before you went totally online? Because there are some of us who, if you took our ability to jump over tables, dance on the table, yell across the That's room, right. where they got That's to right. see us face to face, and took that out of the equation, I don't know if some of us would be very effective as teachers.
Ken, that's a huge factor to consider when you think about this. I'm a big believer in jumping over tables. on this very stage, I've jumped, you know, metaphorically jumped over a lot of tables, done a lot of stunts in here, a lot of gimmicks, you know, roamed all over this room, done all kinds of things that all of a sudden you can't do that exactly the same thing online. But you can make really cool podcasts, you know, and some of them can make a big difference because they can watch them over and over. You know, if you set up something that works really well, you just say, go here and click on this, and then, you know, the exercise will be there for you. That's better. And then, again, I go back to discussions. This was sort of a surprise for me. Once I got the discussions going, I started realizing, gosh, I'm seeing a much richer and more good comments than I used to, especially when they talk to each other. And even online, they discover, oh gosh, there's someone in this class that I know, and they start talking to each other. You know, there are a lot of surprises. Your original question, do I enjoy it as much? I'm not sure yet, because it's a lot of work, and sometimes I don't have time to think about whether I'm enjoying it or not. But when you're getting that positive feedback that the students feel like they're learning, and I did surveys at the end, did you feel you learned more, as much, or less in this as you would in a traditional class? And it was something like 75% said they thought they learned more. That was their own self-assessment, but that's what, and nobody said they thought they learned less. So that was very gratifying. And also surveyed them about accessibility. Did you feel the professor was more accessible, less, or as accessible? And everything was either as or more. So as Adam was saying, students, you know, if it's set up well, they really take to this. So, you know, in the end, you know, we think about our ego. Yeah, I loved being in the classroom, getting that immediate feedback, that all the interaction, you know, people responding. In a way, that's kind of good for our egos. But sometimes you look back and say, well, which way do they really learn the most? And again, I'm talking about a large concept class. I don't know about your skills classes. I could not say if you could ever do it as well online. I honestly don't know. But for a concept class, I think there are ways to find as effective or maybe even more in some ways. So that's what I think right now.
I'll be honest with my fully online class and say I like teaching in the classroom more. I really do. That's something that I cherish, and I really am passionate about that classroom experience. I also studied it, and I did pre and post surveys. I will say that in my online class, outcomes were just as much, or actually in some cases better, than face-to-face, you know? And I mean, an affordance of online is my jokes never bomb, you know? Like, and I just put the joke out there and I just assume everyone's laughing, you know? So there are things in which really go over well online. I had a student on my evaluation said, you know, this is my favorite instructor I've ever had and I never met him, you know? And I was like, I don't know what that says about me, but maybe I work better in virtual anyways. And so it's a real struggle for me is, you know, I'm really passionate about the classroom experience and being able to feel like I'm building this relationship with the students, but I think we also have to recognize that we have to put the students' needs before our own egos, and so I'm committed to online because I know it can be effective and it can be a way to enhance that student experience, even if I like it slightly less than I like my classroom experience. I know it works at least equal, if not better, in some instances for my class.
Oh, I just wanted to add, this is just one anecdote, but it was at the end of the first fully online Mass Cum Laude this summer. A student emailed me unprompted, you know, the day I sent them the last email and said, okay, you know, we're done now. You know, it was good, you know, teaching you and all. Have a good summer and all. And unprompted, and the thing she said is what I will always stand out. She said, thank you for making me feel like a real person and not just, you know, a digit online. And so there are ways to connect with people, even online, so...
Quick question, you know, how do you go about getting the university, the college, to support what you're trying to do? As Robert knows, you know, we created something that teach students breaking news in an online world. We got no support from the college. We got no support from the university. It cost one teacher her tenure. How do you go talk a little bit about how do you go about building that support. The only place we got support was from OG&E, and they gave us 10 grand because they saw the vision.
Well, I think that needs to continue to grow. It's not where it needs to be. I think, our new interim Dean Kelley has already told me that he sees that as something we need to be doing more of, helping teachers just provide the content, and then, you know, the college will help provide the electronic framework in which to do these kind of things. But I don't know, I'm kind of independent, you know. It's one thing I love about teaching in higher education, you know, if you decide you want to do something, if it doesn't cost much money, you can just go do it. I mean, D2L doesn't cost me anything, so I just go do things. There was a little bit of, you know, a small incentive for developing the fully online course this summer, and you might remember we had someone from the business college here talking about how they did that. They provided small financial incentives to develop online courses, and of course, you know, I raised my hand and said, "Hey, why don't we do that?" And we do a little bit of that now. I hope we do more. I hope we do a lot more. It doesn't take a lot, just a little bit of incentive. I think you're talking about something that needs more actual. You have things you need to pay for, right? So that's, I don't know, that's a bigger discussion. I've never had to. That is tough, though. I mean, the technology committee, I know from working with them in the past, I can hear it's tough to get money out of them. I haven't dealt with them lately, but in the past, things were challenging. And that's probably something we need to evolve as a college and as a Mark's office, they have a lot of different ways to help you. I don't know specifically with what you're looking at, but that's one thing I would do. I would go talk to CTE and see, is there something here that we might be able to do? You know, because I have a feeling the university has a growing interest in this and is going to find more funding in the future, I think. So.
Hello, I'm a second year doctoral student here. I have two questions. First, have you ever considered to include students outside of Gaylord, outside of OU, even from overseas, to involve in your class? And second question is, do you have any ideas about promote your class to more students? Thank you.
So my class, you know, I subscribe also to the idea of whatever you want your students to do, you should try to do yourself. And so my class is also built on a domain, and it's openly available on the web in its full capacity. And I've done that in a way in which anyone can access materials, and that I want it to be shared that way. I want to be building things. Now, that also gets embedded in D2L, so the students here at OU also get it within a D2L environment, but I want it to be something in which more people can, for, you know, if anything, help me make a better course. You know, I want people to poke at it a little bit, and I hope that it gets some criticism from somewhere. I want it to be better, and so that's one way that I've thought about it is let's not build everything that we do in silos in which no one can reach. There's places and times for that, but you know we can take advantage of things like the World Wide Web, you know, to help engage more people with what we're doing.
Well, I thank you for asking that, Ying. Ying is actually my graduate assistant, and I didn't tell her to ask that question, but those two questions, those are two things that she and I are going to be working on this year, is trying to figure out how to, now that we have Mass Comm Law online, and I think someday, you know, the history course may be fully online, how do we start taking this beyond the Gaylord College to other students at OU, and then beyond OU? How do we take this to the world? And when we were talking the other day, I was a little surprised, but I was happy, and I kind of had a vague instinct. She said, yes, I think, you know, there are many students in China who would be interested in learning more about U.S. media law and U.S. media history, which is really not just U.S. media history. But anyway, I think we do need to be thinking about that. And Ying is going to help me this year figure some of those things out. And I hope other people, too, because, you know, that's that's a huge market for the future, is getting people beyond just Gaylord College to have an interest in some of our courses, I think. And I don't know what it'd be like to teach someone in China online, but I hope I do it before too much longer. I hope that happens, or anywhere else. So, you know, I welcome anybody who wants to get these discussions going around here. I think we should, because a lot of it's just mechanics. Like, I'm not sure how do I change a course that anyone in Gaylord, any senior can sign up for Mass Comm Law, or I think any upperclassman can sign up for the history course. How would you change it so that other students at OU could take it as these courses as electives? I don't know how to do that yet, but Ying and any of the rest of you who can help me, I look forward to that.
Okay. Any other questions? It's about 20 after, and we have our next speaker at 10:30. So do you want to take a few minutes, or should I make something up? I can make up a question. They always start with, where do you get off? But anyway, thank you very much, and thank you to our panel.
I wanted to embarrass you, Adam, but I believe those things.
And this is really interesting.
I meant to give you some credit.
Thanks,
thank you. It's more or less permanent
now. It is.
There's a lot of things, and a lot of times it's resources.
Community, all of those.
More than that.
You probably talked too much.
No, nobody talked too much.
Hello, how are you doing?
I'm the person who would use this.
Perfect. I'm going to get it all set up here. Yes, sir. We'll try to figure it out. Sorry.
I can't stand up. I have to jump over tables.
Explanation of it, I think, is really asked some very interesting questions about how to think about what we're doing.
So,
yeah, I'll send it to you. Sorry, let me get my junk out of
here.
Oh,
no, all good.
You can leave me the screen.
I was testing the presentation out because it hasn't been full screen yet.
Check.
Going full screen for me. No, it's working now. When I use PowerPoint, doesn't go full screen. So I got to figure out why. Oh, you have to do that? Okay, sorry, I'm just trying to make sure I'm good. Design for home? Is it home? Where the heck is this one? Slideshow. Oh, here we go. Is a.
Check.
Where's the weird view?
Click and unclick on presenter view.
No, I think it goes into it. Yeah, we don't want presenter view.
So why is it not?
Where is the?
Do you know who our next speaker is?
Yes, he's going to the restroom.
Okay.
You
can entertain
them, but well, I'll wait for it. I hate PowerPoint.
Let's see. I gotta remember how to do this.
The way of stuff that they use.
Not presenter.
What do you use?
Yeah. It won't play more.
I gotta figure out. No, what's
the
mirror?
It sticks to presentation. In presentation, it goes into resolution. The projectors won't work on the Mac side. This will never work on a projector unless you go to Apple Presenter View. But this is the newer version. Do we have the old version on this computer? Do you still have the old version?
Hold on. I'm gonna look up how to mirror.
Can you help me move this table, that is?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're marked evaluations. I'd love to get the guy for his. Yeah, sure. Would that be great? Yeah, thank you. Would that be great?
Trick it?
You trick it? I don't know.
Oh, that's how you do it. I figured it out.
He also wanted a remote. What are you doing?
I figured it out. There's a new button. It's called swap.
Swap?
Should I come back? I have to replug.
Hey, don't you always fails when you need it the most. It's like a... We have a Windows, came on a Windows disk, and now it's a new version of PowerPoint, and now the PowerPoint presentation won't work, and so now we're working.
I think you make a real version of PowerPoint. Work.
Well,
no,
I can project. Get it to work. I just need to get the projector to come back now.
It doesn't project properly.
Do we just have one presenter at this point?
Yes, this is just one person, correct.
We have two coming.
Right? No, for this presentation, it's just him.
Mark's following me.
On this one?
Yeah, just one person for this particular presentation. Why I lose
mine? When we lose it, we can never get it back. That's the problem we've always had with this. We may have to go start restart the system.
See if I can understand
that. Not that bad.
Yeah. Oh, it's the laptop connection.
It is the laptop. So this has happened before, and we always had to restart the system. When we lost the ability to switch the laptop, we had to restart it.
Displays. It's
that one thing we can't get in the fixes. We can't reproduce it when it happens. We can't ever get it to work, and then it works.
It always does that, yeah.
We have to restart it. We get the system on the phone. We need to know pretty quickly what it happens.
We can, what, you think it's a HE projector?
Yeah, it's the Crestron area.
Okay, well, you can, the other one's got brand new lights.
Don't use the other one. We don't have to. What do we have to do? What's the best solution? I hate that other projector. It's going to look so bad in comparison.
It's got a new lamp. Are you the presenter?
Yes. Oh, you're going to mic me up?
Yeah, well, I'm just going to put a lob. You want to just...
I'm going to put it in my pocket?
Push it back and forth.
That's fine. Okay.
How long does it take to get
this in?
5 minutes?
Just
reboot it.
Okay.
Okay.
You may get rid of some of this.
Thank you, sir.
So you look good.
No, thank you. Another thing is, I...
Can we reboot the system so we can use the HD projector?
See, the two buttons?
I don't know. He knows what he's doing.
Okay.
We have to reboot the system. There's a bug that happens about every 15 times we use it where we can't switch to this mode.
Oh,
the only
I
solution
see.
Is to reboot the system. So I said, go reboot it. It'll be 5 minutes. It'll be back up. And we when we like call IT over to solve it, we can't ever reproduce the problem. When it happens, it happens. When it's solved, it's solved.
Yeah, I know. It's one of those things that you have to just live at the moment.
Well, rebooting the system solves the problem, so we're just going to reboot the system and go on. That's the best solution.
I can leave this one on, too, you know, that way, if you want.
What would we need it? That one works, though, right?
Yeah. Sometimes...
You're the expert. I don't know. We want to use the HD projector, and I do, because David finally got this working for us for everything.
Yeah, and I've seen this being used. It's phenomenal.
It looks much better, but when it doesn't work, it doesn't work.
If when it works, it's a complete bomb. I know.
We can talk about how
that is true for all technology, isn't it?
We can talk about how great it was. Until
stage right pocket, right?
So do we have the other version of PowerPoint on here? The old version?
No, but I know how to make it work. You just click a button called Swap Displays, and it makes it the normal way instead of the presenter view.
There's a bug.
I just couldn't hit it because
there's also a bug in PowerPoint for Mac that keeps presentation from working on projectors and displaying. All of them. They all have the same problem.
It's annoying, isn't
it? It is.
It's a Microsoft bug. We don't have it's also not the newest version. 365 doesn't work.
Huh?
This is 2013, not 365, isn't it?
365.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Awesome. Yeah. I haven't tested PowerPoint.
That's why I said we have the old version.
Hello there. Hi. Yeah.
And I don't, I mean,
this would be 7.
Exactly. That's exactly right.
Hi there.
Hi.
I'm Professor Ghosh from the College of Business.
I'm Kat. I'm the librarian here.
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you.
Thank you. It's a little cool over here, isn't it?
I know.
They're really, maybe they cranked up the air conditioning, think it'll be more people, but I, you know, there's a lot of...
It's
It's
I can hear you echoing.
No, because I got my mic on.
Yeah. Okay. Just don't go to the
podcast.
That's happened more times than people realize.
I've not done it, but people have done it, and it's I come back, I said, then the people look at him and said, so what are you looking at me for? I said, do you realize what the mic was on? Hi there. Professor Ghosh, nice to meet you. So are you a student here?
Oh. I am a campus rep for Apple. So I'm listening to how y'all are incorporating technology into the classroom.
Okay. Well, I'm going to speak in a few minutes, but that program wouldn't have happened without technology. I mean, that's the benchmark, that's our entire platform. The target audience, the program structure wouldn't have happened without technology. It's not possible. It wouldn't be possible.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can't expect these people to quit the job and come to a program. So.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right, nice chatting with you. Hi.
Hi. Where are you going? Okay.
What? It's
I don't know about any of it. It's just crazy. No, but he thinks the cable was bad. We had it working fine.
Do you have a just a plain drop screen now?
No, it's not that now. The cable, the cord going to this. You can Apple TV from this. We're going to use Apple TV to bypass the cord. It's not listed.
I got to redo that. It's because it's my IP address from upstairs.
It's a technology session. It should be working.
And Michael's going to stay here because it'll probably jump off. We have to restart this thing back here probably. Right. I said it's every time we do something, something doesn't work. It doesn't matter how much planning you do. This auditorium has never been a plug-and-play auditorium. Get the Apple TV back there.
Is it?
It's back in here. Somewhere back in the chart, in the cabinet.
Oh, it is.
What are you looking for? It's in the back. It's back in the cabinet. You know where it is?
Oh, yeah. Hold on one second.
Big Apple. My name is Professor Ghosh.
I'm David Candy.
Nice to meet you, sir. Nice to meet you. So are you part of the technology group over here?
I am their engineer.
Oh.
So I was one that installed all their new HD 2 suites and all the infrastructure over in the broadcast area.
Oh, fantastic. So when I'm walking down all those fancy things put up were your handiwork. And I was walking down on the other side, there was the various rooms with cameras and all those TVs and all those things.
Yeah, I redid the suite in 1000, and then suite A, and then all the infrastructure last year.
Ah, okay.
I don't do IT.
You don't do IT, okay. So,
I do, but I'm being drug into it. I got 34 years of broadcasting.
So the reason I'm asking is because this whole idea of, I may think of some questions. One of the challenges that I face is to, when I teach the online part, is there are various people scattered all over the world. And while IT does help, the cable is there. Fast and furious. Some of them ask the question, can I do this, you know, on my, instead of a computer, on my television? I said, I'm sure you can. You just got to have the right.
I spent 4 years at OSU with long distance education. And we taught German, algebra, everything online to high school students.
Ah, okay, well, there you go.
Looks like we're getting close. We didn't want to run through this whole presentation for the one to see.
I'm going on the main slide.
So how does one go from screen to screen?
You just use your right click here.
Okay.
Your right arrow. We'll move you to the next slide.
Okay. So I'm on the right one, go to this one. Okay. Fair enough.
I'm going to stand right up here to make sure nothing.
I'll do a quick introduction.
Oh, okay.
And we'll start.
Absolutely.
Okay?
Absolutely.
We're doing a workaround, so you may have to be here to put it back online.
Okay. That's fine. I've got to leap along, so I guess.
Okay. Let's go ahead and take our seats and resume our program.
People are socializing, so I think it's Friday off, Friday morning.
Our next speaker from Price College is a busy, busy man. Dr. Dipankar Ghosh is a David Ross Boyd and David C. Steed Professor of Accounting. As importantly, he was instrumental in the design and delivery of the Energy Executive Management Program, which is a 5-day program providing overview of the business side of an energy enterprise. And he is the principal architect of the Executive MBA in Energy, a 15-month hybrid program that began in January 2014 and has had great success, not only at Price, but here at OU. So Dr. Ghosh, thank you so much for being here today. We look forward to your presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mark, first, thank you for inviting me. I'd like to share some thoughts over here. So the Executive MBA in Energy program is a truly audacious program from the Price College of Business. It's bold, it is aspirational, but it couldn't have happened without technology, frankly speaking. So I'd like to kind of share with you what we did. It's a very, very new program, and so many aspects of it is so brand new that as we started going forward, almost everything we had to kind of think outside the box. So when Mark asked me to kind of talk to you about the program, I said, you know, I cannot kind of put down every nuance that I went through half an hour conversation. It would be awfully boring and very tedious. So what I thought, I'd come up with the overarching framework of what we went through and then leave a lot of time at the back end to ask any questions, because I'm quite, you know, a lot of the things is very idiosyncratic to this particular program and may not apply to everybody. But that's for somebody else to make a decision and go from there. Right? So, but before going further, keep in mind that it's a bold program, and we did not take this huge leap of faith. You know? And what we did was we took a couple of learning steps before going forward. So, Dean, in an introduction, kind of mentioned it. So, kind of put a background to it. So, as we know, this energy space is huge at OU. I mean, it's 22% of a country's GDP. You take football out of the equation, and Oklahoma and energy goes hand in hand. And OU start a tradition in energy goes 100 plus years. So if you look at this over here, in the Price College of Business, our energy management program has been around for a long time. That has given, when I put it at the very bottom, is because it really provides the platform. It's been there since 1958, a long time ago. Then in 2008, I was asked to be the director of the MBA program, and I want to make it something different to it. Some of the first thing that I did was add an energy specialization in the MBA program. We have several faculty members who had worked in the industry before coming over as academics, so we had subject matter expertise, but not any subject being offered. As I was doing that, several of my colleagues and friends asked me, Dipankar, can you put together something shorter so that I can go to school for a year and a half or 2 years? So that kind of led you in 2011 to the one-week energy executive management program, a 30,000-feet perspective on the business side of energy. And it's still going on very successfully. The dean that time wanted to take that particular program and make it online, and I said, you know, we have enough expertise and enough knowledge to have a brand new program. So around fall of 2011, I started working on the EMP program, and that's what I'm going to talk about the next few minutes. Okay? So kind of quick perspective what the program is all about. We deliberately decided to focus on energy, all right? And if you take the take it down to the core, it is primarily oil and gas. It has a course on alternatives. It has a course on contracts in a broader scheme of things. But I wanted to tackle the 800-pound gorilla to begin with, which is the energy, oil and gas. Number two is it's a 15-month program. Again, why 15-month? I'll come to that in a moment. It was interesting choice and talking to a lot of VPs and the kind of people you want to go after, 15 months become pretty viable. I'll talk about that. 36 credit hour, 22 courses, of which 8 are taught face to face, and I'll talk about it in a moment. And 14 of them are offered entirely online. The price is $77,400. Was done on competitive analysis, who the competitions are providing. But we also cover in the cost all books, all computers, all the learning materials. We cover that. And we have three, the program is structured such a way we've got the first week and last week on campus, and the middle one is in London. I want to give the global perspective. We provide accommodations and meals in all the places. Program launched in 2014, two starts a year, roughly 20 students each time. Minimum 8 years of work experience. Again, why? Because this program is geared towards future leaders in the industry. And talking to the VP of HR in various oil and gas companies, this is roughly around 7 or 8 years when you begin to see a separation between people who are geared towards the top level and those people who are kind of followers. And then the underlying theme going all the way through is globalization and leadership. So those courses on that, I've hired an executive career coach in leadership and so on and so forth. So this is the overarching thing. Now let's talk about the exact process we went through. And the next slide is a busy slide. So there are 5 stages. So discover, develop, build, launch, and then manage. So discovery process started in fall 2011. I went to Arizona State University. The dean there was an a colleague of mine. Spent a couple of days there, exactly what they did on online part. I mean, I was amazed how extensive the operation. They have even their own server in the college, in the business school. They don't depend on the university facilities. Okay. So the first 4 items on that first slide, discover was key. Who was the target audience? Who we are going after? Okay, we want somebody who's 30 plus, an adult learner, all right, in the oil and gas sector, who are targeted to be future leaders. That drove, number one, 2 things. How long should the program be? So 15 months didn't come out of nowhere. The thought process was that 2 years, they're working 60, 70 hours a week, or 80 hours a week. They travel a lot. Can they kind of pull this off for next 2 years? 1 year is too short, 24 months is too long. So kind of settle in between. All right, how many hours can they potentially study? 30 to 35 hours, no more than that. Expecting beyond that is expecting way too much. And that all those things combined to come up with the pricing. So a lot of the discovery process focused around those 4 things. Then coming up with the various courses and the topics, 2 credit hours, 1 credit hours, is all depend upon what the content is being delivered. I had put together a committee which involved a couple of my faculty members and BP, Shell, and Devon. They were kind of my professional partners. Even naming the program, we went back and forth. We should call it EMBA or EEMBA, EMBA Energy. We went back and forth on the issue. So this was going on till spring 2012. Then sometime in 2012, we said, well, let's do it. We have enough of talking. Let's get on with it. Of course, the first thing is to get the program approved. But the next 2 items, selecting the course developer, that was not our core competency, the technology part. We had to get somebody who can help us launch it. And so we had several vendors who come and presented, and they're all over the spectrum. And we went with somebody who was relatively small, all right? They had the knowledge, they were very eager to work with us, but they have not really worked with any major players. They worked with a lot of small universities, and they definitely did not work with courses which are more quant-driven. They're done a lot of liberal arts stuff. It's a different kind of course development. That took us a lot of time, selecting the course developer and selecting the technology. For example, we decided to go with Canvas. not D2L. Because what we found out that Canvas lends itself to more collaborative learning than D2L. It was something that was approved by the university, and we have a separate license working directly with Canvas. Okay? Identify the faculty, again, it was an interesting task because that was one of the biggest challenges, as we know that most of us are not exactly, we are digitally challenged, just a better word. And convince them to teach was something, a bit of a chore. Also, I wanted to bring in industry people to be teachers, because remember, we had 8 courses taught face-to-face, so all the face-to-face courses are taught by very, very senior energy professionals, right, so at the VP level and above. The remaining, all the online courses were taught by our regular faculty, OU, and we have a faculty member from the College of Law. Develop student service models. I'll come back to them in a moment. And then, of course, how do you go about getting accreditation? Because one of the things that had to be done at some point in time, the accreditation process. So what mechanism you put in place right up front that will allow us to get that? Then the building the program. So building the online program, it sounds awfully simple, but that was an extremely difficult task. Keep in mind, in a traditional classroom, when I go in to teach, well, I have a syllabus, I'm pretty organized, I know what I'm gonna teach day-to-day basis. Oh, worry about the exam later on. No, you've got to have the full script up front, meaning right from day one to the last day, what should be your delivery materials, what should be your exams, what should be your quizzes, how will you grade them? Everything has to be locked down. It's like producing a movie. You got to have the script first, and then you produce it. So therefore, identifying the faculty and working with them to ensure they understand what it really means was critical. And it takes roughly about any particular 1-credit hour class takes roughly about 3 to 4 months to get it done, and a 2-credit class a little longer. So, again, for me, it was a major, major challenge because since I was teaching the accounting class right up front, being that disciplined was incredibly hard. I had to kind of write up every quiz on every chapter, on every material from day one. And I never taught that way before. That was a challenge. Then the online training facility for the faculty, again, was a challenge because how you get them comfortable teaching them in the new platform. Then I have to train the admission people, the marketing people, and so on and so forth, the infrastructure. Because this is a very service-oriented program. We are teaching executives they have high expectations. So how do you deal with when these people ask questions? You've got to have the service mentality. They are not your traditional students. Then we essentially launched the program in 2014. Of course, we started marketing the program in late summer, early fall of 2013. And that was a challenge. Who do you market it to? Do you market it to the VPs and those kind of people who make decisions who should attend the program or to the target audience directly? So we took a twin approach, did both. The first classes we started in 2014 with 18 students. Since then, we started this past August with the fourth class. And to manage is a continuous issue. The first thing, of course, admitting the right student. When I designed the program, I waived out taking a GMAT because GMAT really doesn't tell me much. So somebody asked for 10 to 11 years, how do you assess his or her ability to take this program? So that's one thing. Going forward, communication is the key. Communicating with the students, feedback, communicating with the faculty. It's imperative that you keep the dots connected across all the players, right? Prompt response to emails. I said earlier on over here that developing a service model, it is critical to understand this is a different group of students. We can't have faculty members responding to an email 3 days later, not acceptable. You gotta respond pretty quickly because they will typically work. So your flurry of emails will come typically when? 6:30, 7 o'clock at night because they finish working, go back home, have dinner, and they start working, okay? So for example, when I teach in this module, I typically start responding to emails between 8:30 and 9 and go to 11:30 at night. And when I get up in the morning at 5:36, I respond for about 45 minutes before coming to school. So it's an intense period. And use the word flexibility. That is true, it is flexible, but online learning is relentless. The students have to be disciplined, okay? And when you design the program, the learning outcome that we had for each course was very helpful because we decided in week one, we're gonna cover this. This is the learning outcome. So, and then week two, when week one finished, week two opened up. Because if you opened up all 7 or 8 weeks at one shot, it was kind of chaotic. Students kept jumping around here and there. So that goes back to the original point that everything has to be fairly structured, right? Then in addition to this thing, how do you keep the program growing? Mind you, that it's an executive program, so it's imperative that they remain connected, all right? So the program is very, very collaborative, and I'll come to a point in a moment, but even off besides that, we have to have events which will bring everybody together, right? So for example, on October 16th, I'm hosting an event in Houston called Connecting the EMBA Community. I've invited all 76 of them, the alums, current students who just started, and having the president of Plains All-American come and talk about future of crude in North America, very appropriate given the timing. And as of yesterday, 32 of them signed up. And mind you, they are from all over. Right now, I've got 19 states covered. So they're not only from Houston. They're coming from various parts of the U.S. Now, I recognize we can't have everybody come, so I'll have an event in fall on campus and in spring somewhere else, most probably Houston. And then keeping the topics current, that's critical. You've got to kind of keep it current because given the audience, it is imperative that they can see what's going on in the world and we can adapt in the classroom. So, but all this would not have happened without the technology, the how the courses are developed. And let's come to a moment over here. So, we're doing our time over here. Okay. Where is it? Okay, so online learning over here. So what it is not text under the glass. It's a live session where all students are just merely present looking at the screen and is passively watching videos of classroom lectures. This is none of them. By design, this is a highly interactive classroom. We begin in class one, in week one, where we do a lot of things in the classroom and also the classroom to bring the class together. It's imperative that the class comes together because when they go off campus, it's a very lonely process. And when they start working in teams, they need to know who they're working with, all right? So it's a low residency deliberately because you don't expect these people to quit their job and come to campus. So those 3 one-week sessions are essentially low residency program, which appeals to a lot of them, and London is particularly appealing to all of them. Highly collaborative. Every class, we talked several times, every class has discussion questions, and it's amazing how much they learn from each other. Actually, the first class, when they graduated, they want to download all the discussion and make it into some kind of a blog. I couldn't do it because since it's being used for grading purposes, you cannot use that for blogging purposes. There's kind of a university ruling on that aspect. The instructor-led courses, why? Because when we design the program, we let each faculty member design the course along, depending on his or her pedagogy. There are two ways of doing it. You can have a shell, all right, and then you just teach within the framework of the shell, or you let the faculty member design the course entirely up to how he or she wants to do it. We took the latter approach, but mind you, that makes it much more expensive. So suppose Professor A quits and Professor B comes on board, it's starting all over again, okay? We just can't say, take A and adapt to it. Asynchronous and asynchronous, so a lot of it is asynchronous, but every class has at least 1 to 2 hours of live sessions every week. I mean, I have an office hour. I call it office hour, but everybody logs on, and we talk on specific issues. I tell them we're going to talk about this. And it's very interactive, and the collaborative allows you to raise your hand. I see you, Mr. X or Ms. Y wants to raise a question, and I raise the hand, and I say, okay, let's go ahead and talk about it. I put the video off because it takes up too much of bandwidth, but I can do so. And lastly, connecting the dots across courses is important to understand that technology allows you to do so. For example, in class number 6, if I want to pull something from class number 1 and say, hey, do you recall we did this? I can feed that into class number 6 and get a quick overview before going forward. Okay. Well, that's my presentation and quick overview, and at this point in time, any questions? Go ahead.
What program are you using, Skype, or what are you using for those 2-hour discussions?
No, we actually go on, we use Canvas. Canvas. On a Canvas, there is we can have something on Collaborate, okay, or something called Zoom. We have used so far Collaborate, but I'm seriously looking into using Zoom because collaboration has some limitation. For example, it's difficult to just upload things like Excel or Word. You got to do it in a PDF format, which kind of really messes it up. So I'm looking at Zoom even as we speak, because there's some other advantages in Zoom besides collaborate.
Could you talk a little more about what went into the faculty training?
Yeah, the faculty training went as essentially, the primary aspect was making them familiar with the software, the Collaborate and the Canvas, for example. How do they, we had somebody working with us in terms of developing the courses and putting it on, but then how do you use it? For example, if you give them assignments, how do you do the grading? You have a speed grader, which will automatically grade for you, but you have to do certain things to ensure that you do it in an appropriate fashion for them to capture your grades. Comments, you have the comments, how do you kind of capture it and send it to the students? How do you do the live sessions? That's the biggest challenge, because you have multiple tools at your disposal. You can show a clipping of a video, you can show a little bit of Excel. How do you kind of manage the flow of traffic? For example, I had my office hour yesterday. I had, out of the 19 students, 18 were logged on. How do you manage the flow? You have to ensure that somebody doesn't dominate the conversation. How do you pull information from your different files and show it? Because you can literally have a whiteboard, and you can put anything on the whiteboard, and whatever you see, they see, number one. And you can write on it, all right, literally, and what you write, it gets captured. But it's a little bit of training along, primarily in the technology space.
How much time was invested in training the faculty?
The training session went over 3 weeks. Roughly speaking, and there were six stages, you know, and then at the very end, there's something called a sandbox where you are put in the shoes of a student, and how you are seeing the faculty member, and then you're put inside of a faculty, so it's an interactive process. So, roughly, there were six stages, and it takes about between 25 to 30 hours easily, and then of course you have to ensure that you the second time you teach you revisit. That because once it was developed specifically for this particular program, and so it's there for you to use for forever. So like when I did it, the first time I spent an ungodly number of hours, but second time I did it, I revisited because you forget some of the stuff, some of the nuances, which are, the Collaborate is a very powerful tool, but it has so many sub aspects to it that if you don't use it for a moment, you forget about it. So. No, this is a brand new program. Okay.
So that kind of brings me to the point. How did you get faculty buy-in for both a coherent major, not like just kind of teaching what you want to teach on the topics, and then secondly, how did you get faculty buy-in for the additional commitments, for example, evening availability for email, and that sort of thing?
Okay. That was the biggest challenge by far, faculty buy-in, because when you went to talk to them, first thing that came to the mind was, oh my God, it's another University of Phoenix program, literally. I said, do you want to be involved with that? So some were kind of easy buy-in, but most of the people said, show me why. Why should I invest in this time? And I said, well, this is where, and I had very good friends in some very well-regarded universities. I brought them down. I got somebody from Darden, somebody from Michigan. They do it. So I said, look, these people are doing it. It's not kind of outside the domain of academic activity. So I think once that helped, then I got somebody else who helped design at USC. So kind of helping the fact that peers around the country have done it was the first option. Second thing is that they all had, majority of them had energy background. So the fact they want to teach to an audience which has that background kind of mildly appealed to them. And third, them I kind of incentivize them, all of them. I kind of work with them so that this is the time you spend. I will incentivize you as you go forward. So whenever they were preparing the courses, they were not doing it for free. I kind of gave them resources, both in terms of TA, GA support, actually incremental pay, whatever it takes. I basically took the model which I used in the Ivy League school, because I have good friends there. I spoke to them. How do they do it? So it's kind of multiple approaches. And now, so some of the people who are the biggest critic are now the biggest supporters, because they love what they do, because the quality of students are fantastic. So it's a kind of a slow process. Mind you, some of them are extremely difficult to convince, but ultimately, majority of them came around. And they recognize that it comes with this territory. When you teach in this program for 8 weeks, it's imperative that you remain responsive. Okay? Otherwise, the students will be, they're brutal in evaluation. They'll tell you exactly that you suck, okay, honestly speaking. They will not hold it back.
I've got a kind of a scary question. I would imagine that you're here because Gaylord might be incentivized to do something similar. You don't have to answer it, but how much did it cost? You hire consultants, you got Canvas, you maybe incentivized instructors. You don't have to answer that, but I'm interested.
$500,000. Give or take.
I had a question related to that. You seem to be have a potential to recoup that $500,000 if it's, what was it, $78,000 mm-hmm. for the program.
Mm-hmm.
Have you had to make any marketing efforts to persuade, you know, prospective students that it's worth that much money? Or is that perception already out there that this degree is of such value?
Absolutely. The reason is because most graduate programs, when they look at what they look at is your current MBA program vis-a-vis something else you're offering. If your current MBA program is heavily ranked, then anything that you sell becomes easy. Now, our current MBA program is good but not great. So the first question is, what makes this program so special? Why is this program so priced heavily? And why your program is not ranked, so why should you come to your program? I go out a litany of examples. I mean, I talk about who the instructors are, what the course contents are, what we else bring to the table. And now that conversation has gone away completely. Nobody asked that question now. And because I had to do the first couple of times because it's a brand new program, and they're trying to figure out, I'm investing all this money, will this program be even around 2 years from now? But now, when I have conversations with the students, because one of the things that we do is, at the very end, I quote unquote interview every applicant. It's about an easier 1 hour conversation, all right? And I ask them at the very end, any questions for you? And that used to be a routine questions at the 6, 7, 8 months ago. Last cohort, this cohort, that question has never come up. I'm sure it still comes up periodically outside, but it's not a pointed question anymore. Am I making sense? But yeah, it was something in the beginning part, but no longer. Yeah, thank you.
Does this save money presented this way, or does it cost more money? Because the $78,000, does this save money, or does it cost more money?
Save money for the...
I think is a very reasonable figure because I know what the University of Chicago charges.
I know, yeah, I'm quite aware of that. It's a basement price right now, bargain basement price right now. We are making money on this, of course.
You are making money.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I strongly believe that
so
you
should. We have 18 students though.
It's all right, yeah, 18 students. We got 2 starts a year, so 40, roughly 40 students each year.
Okay.
Absolutely, so 18 now. In last class, we had 21. So roughly about 20 students each class, so 40 students each time coming in. The initial cost is pretty expensive because to develop an online course from grounds up is non-trivial. Mm-hmm. So therefore, initial funding was important.
Just to add, when you look at the $500,000, that's a shocking number for faculty, right? But if you take 20 students and put that into it's 25,000. So at 25,000, they would have paid most of their upfront cost to develop it with that one cohort, right? So after that, the maintenance is not $500,000. So no.
Most of it is development cost because to pay the faculty, to get the consultant on board, to design the curriculum, those are roughly, it worked out to between $15,000 to $20,000 per credit hour. That's the development cost of each course. So we needed significant cash inflow in the front end before the revenue started coming in. Yes, sir.
Okay, so your students that you have in there are people who are already in the business, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so basically you could look at this as a finishing school for people that are already in business, and it gives them common language. So that's one of the attractions for it?
Vast majority of the students in the classroom, yeah, it's a finishing school of a different kind in the sense meaning vast majority of them are technical people.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. When I design a cohort, I like to have about half of them as technical, meaning petroleum engineers, whatever they are, then a few landmen, few law people, kind of a collaborative learning process because one of the strengths of the program is the discussion questions, you learn immensely from each other. So yeah, any graduate school in some sort is a kind of, we are providing the business perspective. So I don't teach you energy per se. That's your expertise, whether it's upstream, midstream, downstream, I don't care. What we teach you is the business aspect of the industry that you right. are already very familiar with.
And it gives them a common language and builds a network.
Absolutely.
So that's one of the
networking is critical because on exec program, networking is one of the hallmarks of any good exec program. So we not only have to ensure they're forming collaborative in the program, even when they get out, they are connecting with each other. So the events in Norman we do in Houston I'll be holding is to bring everybody together on a regular basis.
And since energy's gotten to be more and more important to a lot of people, they get to go to the school, they learn how to talk about it to the media.
True.
Okay.
True. One of the things that we actually we're going to do as an add-on session is to precisely along the line, how do you respond to questions from the external constituents? Not so much a media, but so they ask you a question about this company. What would you say? What would you be talking points?
Josh? Right.
Absolutely. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You have to get students to get a program started, et cetera, and you're not going traditional routes up to universities.
How do you, how have you started? Do you go directly to the companies, or do you advertise in trade journals? How do you find the students?
It was multiple approaches. The 1 week, the EMP program that we did, actually, we had prepared a huge database from that. So that was one email blast that went out. Our biggest source has been LinkedIn and Google, surprisingly. I hosted several dinners in Houston and Dallas, talking to the high level. We teamed up with some professional organizations like Society of Petroleum Engineers, et cetera. So it was multiple facets. It was very little in print because okay. most people don't seem to read print. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it's a combination of online, doing webinars, very, very popular, the webinar approach.
Oh, okay.
We had one, we got six this month, and each one of them gets about 20 to 25 people
wow.
easily. Okay? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, kind of pitching it to the highest level in the organization, because ultimately, they are the people who will send people, identify people to come to the program.
The companies are paying the tuition and most
vast majority of them, there are about 20 to 30% of the class, they're paying 100%. But it's not uncommon to have at least 30 to 40% being paid. Only one or two will pay all the way through, but those are relatively rare.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Real quickly, you said you designed the cohort. Could you explain what you mean by you designed the cohort?
The cohort means extreme example, a class size of 20. Having all of them being petroleum engineers coming from Houston will make it a very strong academic class. But from a learning point of view, we'll be kind of one-dimensional. So if I raise a question, I'll get a similar answer from all 20 of them. So I like to have about roughly half of them engineers in all spectrum, midstream, upstream, downstream. So they will each one of them provide their own perspective. But I like to have somebody in the class from landman, a couple of legal people, a couple of finance people. Ideally speaking, I like to have somebody even outside the oil and gas sector. So for example, in this class, we have somebody from biogas. So they bring a different perspective to it. So when I design a cohort, I like to have as much diversity as possible within the context of energy because that enhances the overall learning.
One last question.
If I missed this, I'm sorry. Actually, two parts. Geographically, where are your students? And then two, following up on that earlier question, what would you recommend to a college like Gaylord or any college that was thinking about trying to start an online okay. master's program?
Right now, we have 19 states covered in the U.S. And internationally, I've got, if you want to count Canada, it's 51st state. Canada is there, Dubai, Colombia, Australia, and England. So we have a fairly diverse population in the classroom. In terms of what to start, when we decided to go with this program, we wanted to find something where we can make a difference, where we make an impact. Whether you want to take an existing program and just be another online program where you cannot really charge differential fee, or you want to be something which is unique to you and nobody else can do it, or nobody else can do it easily, and then you can make your name there and then decide to brand it and decide to price significantly differential fee. We chose the latter approach. Okay, we knew where our strength is. We are blessed with having several faculty members working in the energy industry. We've got several alums are highly placed in the oil and gas sector. So we have the core knowledge, we have the support structure, we have the connections. And if tomorrow, if I'm trying to launch a program in entertainment, nobody will take us seriously. So entertainment, Oklahoma, what are you talking about? Oil and gas makes sense. So the brand is automatically there. So therefore, suggestion is if you have a space to go with, by all means, go with it, something that your core competence is. If not, then decide something where you where you think the popularity is. What's the cutting edge issue? But even if you do that, fat changes. And therefore, it's important because these courses, you can't just take somebody from the street and say, hey, go and teach. It takes, I'm constantly kind of thinking about if a particular faculty member moves on, how do I replace him or her? That's a constant challenge because it's not a one-day affair. It's a 6 to 7 month gestation period at least, all right? What happens if somebody goes on sabbatical? What do I do with that? Because I can't just take somebody else and put in the classroom and go and teach. So every aspect of this program is very, very new. So when you start thinking about what you want to do, stay close to your core competency. So in our situation, we had two small steps, the MBA specialization in energy, which I put together, and the one-week program. That gave us the idea how to put a program together, which is energy-centric, all right, and kind of bring the curriculum, which is balances academia with industry expertise. So find your core competences, and I'll stay close to that. And again, leverage off your strength. I mean, one of the things we're toying with was healthcare, but there's nobody in College of Business with healthcare background. So I can't offer a program where I have to take everybody from outside to teach it. It makes no sense. It would be extremely difficult administrative process. Okay? And the funding aspect, you mentioned the issue of where the money comes from. For this one, the funding, money was not sitting around. I had to go and pitch the money to a senior VP of an oil and gas company. They kind of cash flow the front end, literally. In return, what we did, I gave them one free seat for a certain number of years. I couldn't have them, I didn't have the kind of money to do it, to do this kind of program. So you've got to have to generate the cash. When we had vendors coming in, a lot of them were talking about revenue sharing, and I said, no, I don't want to do revenue sharing. Why should I give away my revenue with people who have very little interest in this? They'll just come and do the stuff and get out. I wanted to keep everything in-house. But then I have to raise the funds. So when I met the person, he said, why did you talk to VP of HR? If this person buys in, we are game. And they bought the game, and they gave the money, and we went forward with that. So that's where the funding came from.
Good way to end. Dr. Ghosh, thank you so very, very much.
Thank you. And if you have any questions later on, I'll be happy to meet with anybody. Oh, thank you.
Dr. Ghosh, thank you again. Lots of insight and advice into a fascinating program that obviously has really taken off at Price College. You know, one of the most gratifying experiences I've had in my short time as interim dean the last 6 weeks or so is being able to see all the, really a reservoir of support for Gaylord College all across this great campus of ours, and that certainly includes the Center for Teaching Excellence headed up by Mark Morvant. The center's mission is really simple. It's to bring innovation into the classroom and to share teaching expertise and knowledge with others. And that's what Mark and his colleagues are going to do for the next few minutes. Joining him today are a couple of people that many of you know, Biff Farrell and Keegan Long Wheeler. So Mark, thank you again for being here.
Thanks, sir. I'm gonna try and catch us up on time a little bit, so I'm going to set the timer here because, of course, faculty are programmed for 50 minutes. So I'll put a timer here so I can warm myself. One of the things that I really like to start with is that this was a perfect storm. So I was actually approached a year before I actually accepted the role at the Center for Teaching Excellence to do it, and the truth was at that time it wasn't the right time. But then all of a sudden there were a lot of things that happened. This was the summer 2012, where webcom was really moving. IT had new leadership. The library, we just brought in Rick Luce. And we had the digital initiative on deck. It was fixing to be rolled out, and it was a perfect storm. So I think whenever you think about everything that we're talking about here in EdTech, and Center for Teaching Excellence gets a lot of credit, but the truth is, it's not just us. We got a great team. I'll talk about our team. I'll talk about the resources, but the truth is that we couldn't have done what we'd have done without people like Buddy, without people like Erin, there's another Erin, and Chris and the rest of the teams around campus. So I just want to say that. The other thing I think that I really appreciate with several comments this morning was the fact that this is about learning and about community. And the idea of owning your learning, right? Adam said that. That's a great statement. And the idea that this is peer-to-peer. So the idea about the EMBA, he kind of referred to the fact that, they needed to work together and collaborate, and that collaboration, having different voices was important. One of the things I wanted you to notice is this was my mantra when I came in with Provost Mergler interviewed, and these were the three words I used, right? Inspire, facilitate, and enable. Notice it doesn't say training, development, and instruction, right? We're here to really inspire you to reach further, right? We're here to facilitate communications between faculty and really just enable you by providing a way to communicate and work with each other. So I love this design. This design did come for the teach-in, did come from College of Business, but you notice where it started. It started with your own faculty talking to you about what they're doing. I hope you this just as a beginning to express those communications throughout your college as we go forward. One of the things to kind of think about this that we've put, so some of you know what we've done, some of you've done, so I'm gonna start with the new things this year. In CTE, we have the faculty fellows. These are faculty-led enrichment programs focused on a theme. One of the things we've changed is we used to call everything faculty learning communities, but the truth is that actually is a special pedagogy, and so we're going to change and use the correct pedagogy. So we have faculty learning communities. Those are longer semester or year long, where a group of people to get together around a common goal or around a common project. We have faculty discussions and reading circles. That's where we take a text, take a book, read it together, and we discuss and have conversations about that content. Seminars, small, short engagements. If you're not really sure what growth mindset is, come to one of the 50-minute long seminars, right? Get an idea. That'll let you know whether you want to get involved in the book club or you want to get involved in the learning communities. And then the workshops, right? Those are hands-on learning communities. So what I ask the faculty fellows to do is to try and have something in each one of these categories and develop their own program, right, to enrich the other faculty and help communication start it. So you should have seen these, but I'll go through them real quick. Lupe Davidson is helping us out with transcending boundaries. If you're, please take a look at all of her stuff. The adaptive mind, this is what Ralph brought up earlier with the growth mindset, so metacognition, student recognition. And of course, your one and only Ralph Beliveau, right, is doing digital media and learning. Please, get involved with one of these. These are conversations between faculty, faculty-led programs to enrich other faculty to improve our students' learning. Of course, Keegan, would you please stand up? Please stand up. Please stand up. Keegan, the one-man wonder. He is our ed technologist, and so he's leading this, so you can kind of think about this. We have the three faculty-led. This one is the Keegan-led program, right? And we're looking at lynda.com this year. It's new for us this year, so we're doing a big push on that. We're having a learning community. The first one starts. I know that there were four people from your college that were involved in that learning community, and there'll be workshops. We have the Create. This is one of the, there's a few times in your life where you just get really ecstatic, and last Friday, whenever Adam rolled out the create.ou.edu email, it says it's there for everybody. That was one of those things where I was jumping up and down in my office, right? I wanted to tell everybody, call my wife, The email went out. We're good, right? So he's going to be leading some seminars there and workshops on that. I'll talk a little bit about that one in a minute. And then mobile blogging and scholarships. Again, one of the things that we know is that if you blog in the language you would talk to your grandmother about what you do for a living, right, to the world, what happens is more people come and they look at your scholarly work. They look at the stuff within journals. And it can increase your impact factors, right? So if you think about mobile blogging and scholarship, the idea there is tell the world what you're doing. Get it outside of the ivory tower. One of the other things that several of the units are, several of my staff are doing, and Keegan has taken a good idea that came from Biff and running full steam with it, is not only will we have these in-person ones, we're making these available. So that idea that this is to the world, right? So if you can't make the times, or if you know you decide you want to get involved in lynda.com next year when we're not having as many activities around it, you know, go to these sites. They'll be up there. The entire course is there. The material's there. You lifelong learning, go learn it yourself. On instructional video, Biff, would you stand up? Just in case you're not aware of Biff. So, yeah, thank you. Biff has been leading our instructional video. He's the one that made the videos around our signature courses. He's also the one that made our videos for the Teachers That Inspire. He's created a lot of the great content that's been coming out of the Center for Teaching Excellence. And, of course, he's had some courses, creating course videos. Again, there's the website. You can go. You can see all of the lessons, the entire program. And then making videos at your fingertips. The other thing that we did, that we have now as a resource for the university, is our video studio. So we now have a new 4K video studio. It was finished Monday at 10? Yeah, about finished Monday at 10. There's still a few things to do with the editing servers. But that is now going to be available for the university to use. Again, we have the editing serving. We have a production lab. Again, it's not things you don't have here, but in case you can't get time or you want to come down and work with Biff and really talk about how do we create engaging instructional videos versus, you know, commercial videos, please come on down and see us in the video studio and give Biff a call, right? Talk about your teaching toolkits. For the new faculty, we gave them a physical teaching toolkit. And I want to talk a little bit quickly about your teaching toolkits. Learn, that's D2L, learn.od.d2, grades. Feedback to your students is important. They don't know how to adjust their classes, so my big mantra here is use D2L for grades if you don't use it for anything else, so the students know what they're doing. How many people still use a checkbook? Okay, right? We got a few, right? Several of us started our lives with a checkbook, right? And I, in my mind, knew how much money I had in the bank account back in the 80s and the 90s, right? Because you had to have, do I have $100? Do I have $200, right? Do I write this check? Do I not write this check? Do I try and run away, right? So you had to know that in your mind, right? And the same thing when people turned back our papers, right? We knew exactly what our grade was because we had to keep track of it in our mind. Students don't have to do that, right? Because they never kept a checkbook, right? So they don't, when you turn back all your papers, they don't know what their grade is in the class, because they're not really programmed to keep track of that essential data. Because one of the more important pieces of essential data they have is on their phone at any time they want, down to the decimal point, right? So please use grades. My media, again, creating and hosting video content. Besides our video studio, they have the video booth down in the lower level, lynda.com, and then, of course, create. So create, again, empowering digital scholarship. You heard many people talk about giving students their own domains, giving the students and faculty a space to play in. I'm very big on the fact that we give you an office, right? We may give you a technical lab, a facility to do your research, to do your scholarship, right? In this now and day, you need a digital space. You need that blank digital canvas that you can create your artwork in, right? And so that's what this is. Please go look at that. Please sign up for it. It's there for you. And again, it'll change your students' lives, right? They need to know because they're living in a world, but they have to have a digital presence. You will be advantageous if you have a digital presence. A few examples of how faculty use it. Here is a research lab, the Scorpion Lab, Doug Gaffins. Here they're using it on a bibliography, kind of a scholarly work. They're trying to collaborate with a few units to build some conferences, build some cross-institutional work. And here's a course, so Origins of Christianity. This used to be a 1.5-inch black and white, all-text course pack that cost $40 just in printing costs, right? Now it is free. Now it is engaging. Now it has a timeline and a map, and the timeline goes back to Student Create. The students can put information in a Google Sheets. It populates the timeline GS, and all of a sudden, they're creating the resource for the course. So great ways to use Create. Of course, out of the center, we also use Janex. Since Adam is here, Adam is our, not only is he the future of digital learning, he's also the director of digital learning at the University of Oklahoma. We're very lucky to have him, and he leads the Janex team. And I think that a lot of people have seen Janex, and over the last 6 months, I've heard a lot of questions about it, and I just want to kind of give you some information. First of all, it's focused on community. The platform is built around social and connected learning. Okay, it is not only open, it's not only online, it's also blended, enhanced, and a supplement. And enhanced means that you're just creating some content or you're creating a social environment, right? You use it for helping your class. A supplement means like in general chemistry. We created for general chemistry. It has some test questions. It has a few videos. They don't really use it for class, but the students have it, right? So the students can use it anytime. That's a supplement. So don't think about Janex as just one thing, right? The other next is it's graduate and undergraduate, right? Most of the focus you've seen in undergraduate, but we're making a very, very strong push into graduate. One of the reasons for that is when you look at online master's programs, again, the exemplar at the University of Oklahoma is the EMBA in energy program. That is the exemplar. That is the future of programs when you look around the U.S. is these cohort-based short, intensive programs. That's what people mid-career need. And I think if you think about journalism, if you think about mass communications, I don't think it's going to take you very long to think about the fact that this would be gold in this college, right? So we're building one out for our global affairs and data analytics, customized to your teaching style. As Dipankar said, right, they went with the fully custom. That's what we do. We start with a conversation with the faculty. We fully customize the class. And it's not just videos. Again, the high-quality videos is what you see. It's the easy thing to show for a Janex, but the truth is the Janex is a social learning platform. And therefore, you could have an entire course in there that was only textual information and the social platform, right? Don't think that it's only that. And then the next thing is that we're having a reboot that's going to have some authoring tools that's going to allow us to really push Janex next. You might have saw something last fall. Because we were waiting for a really big upgrade in the system, we're going to be pushing that out in the spring. And that'll allow us to expand the reach of what Janex can do on campus. Okay. The other things we do, we support everything that Dr. Simon Poulat does as the Vice Provost of Faculty Development. So that's the new faculty programs, promotion and tenure. If you are in the tenure clock, remember promotion and tenure workshop early and often. Come as many times as you want for that. And then the new chairs and directors programs, and there's going to be some other leadership programs that Dr. Pilat is going to be pulling out. So please be watching for those. Of course, the other thing that we do is the graduate teaching assistance program. So we have the teaching assistance orientation and the development for instructional TAs program. This year, we have a reboot of our graduate teaching academy. Before, we had a graduate teaching academy, great idea brought to us by a faculty member. Again, faculty members coming to the university saying, hey, why don't we do this? And somebody going, oh, that's a decent idea. Had a little bit of money to pay some food for graduate students to show up, and we have a new program, right? And but the program was about 12 sessions in the fall and about 12 sessions in the spring. And one of the things we did from analysis, we found out that when we quit offering dinners at night and went to snacks in the afternoon, we went from 50 to 12. It's not bad, because if you think about it, you know, 38 of those people were just there for food. So we really didn't change our impact. We just changed our cost, right? But one of the things about that when looking at it and looking at other programs was it was this big whole or nothing thing, right? And so we hired a graduate student and said, what I want you to do is think about what you would want if you could have anything as a graduate student learning how to teach better. They brainstormed with Jason Fitzsimmons, one of our our great digital, our learning designers, right? And they came up with this program. So we have seminars now, we have practicum. They are buffet, you take what you want, right? But we also have achievements. We've gamified it. We have achievements so you can be a Graduate Teaching Academy fellow, a senior fellow, or a scholar. So if you want to go to 5 seminars and 1 practicum, you can apply to be a GTA fellow. Game that up a little bit, go up another lecture, get it more involved, and you can do this over several years. You don't have to do this in only 1 year. You can do a little bit this year, a little bit next year. By the time you get your MFA or your PhD, you got your GTA scholars level. Okay. Additional programs. So one of the questions was, how do we support all this? Well, first of all, I've got a huge team. You're going to see all those faces, but of course, Biff, Adam, and Keegan are here, right? But we also do have some funds, right? First of all, the faculty fellows. I gave each of the faculty fellows $10,000, and I said, you create the dream program you want to create. And so far, they've blown me away, right? They've come back with some great ideas. But we also have innovation grants. If you need a small amount of money just to try something in your class, in one case, it was they needed to set up a virtual machine to see if they could do BYOD devices instead of PC only. Well, that didn't cost a whole lot, right? So dropped a little bit of money on that, and they're going to try that out this semester. You know, another one, it was they wanted a small little device that could allow them to take students buildings right over in architecture and make them go through both a wind and a earthquake, right? $750, right? So these are small little grants. We'll be doing a call next month. If you have this small little idea and this could work, you know, let us know. The Course Innovation Program, and of course the JMC 1013 has one of these. This is for the large enrollment. This is for the big bang courses, big impact courses. It's up to $75,000 a year renewable for 2 years. And again, this is to really renovate one of those big, big courses. And again, you heard already several people talking about, you know, giving Adam a call, giving Keegan a call. So for the academic technology, but we also, if you want to brainstorm a course design, if you want to talk about doing that, we have people in the office to do that. So please come see us. Okay. I do want to make one pitch here. I'm still staying within my shortened time span, so we're doing good. Teaching Scholars Initiative. This year, we're going to have the focus is going to be diversity, inclusive, and equity in higher education. That is November 6th. Please put this on your calendars. Okay? We have that one, and we have the Academic Technology Expo. Maybe the guys will come and talk about it in just a minute. Here's my team. Dr. Hong Lin is our associate director. Dr. Jason Fitzsimmons, instructional designer. Biff, our academic multimedia specialist. Sharon, make sure that we run everything smoothly. Andy's a visual designer. Keegan, our educational technologist. Carissa is our amazing new graduate teaching fellow. Jan has been our graduate assistant for a couple of years. And then the digital learning team, led up by our one and only world-renowned Adam Croom and his team, Angie, Anoop, John, and Yana. And then here's our contact. Please come and see us. Please ask us questions. Okay, I knew that most likely in an event like this, either you're going to ask your own faculty a whole lot of time or you're going to ask somebody else a time. So therefore, I gave you a pen, which you can keep, and a piece of paper. In 1 minute, I want you to write down a question you would like me to answer. So this is a 1 minute paper. Okay, this is, I am supposed to be talking about technology, but this is technology. Paper was technology. Pen was a technology, right? I want you to write that question down for me, okay? And then just either get it to me or get it to Keegan or get it to Biff, okay? Then what I will do is I'll answer those. I will send the answers to Buddy, and then Buddy will distribute it to the college, okay? So you got 1 minute, and I have 30 seconds, so go.
Okay.
This one? Oops. Okay. You've got, it was supposed to be a whole minute, but I'm gonna truncate it right here so I can actually do the transition a little bit. I want to set up my next speaker. Which is the only thing I didn't talk about is our work on active learning classrooms. Since our next speaker is going to be talking about active learning classrooms, I do want you to know that PACR, which is the Provost Committee on Classrooms, does have four classrooms, two that are already online, two coming in. And then we do pedagogical training and learning communities and workshops on active learning. So please let you know. And of course, our collaborators are the next two speakers from the Office of Strategic Initiatives and IT Learning. And I'll turn it back to Ed. Thank you, sir.
You've done this a time or two, I can see. Yes. Thank you so much, Mark.
Thank you.
And to describe the characteristics and the concepts behind the active learning classrooms are more friends of Gaylord College, Erin Wolfe and Chris Kobza. Erin is Executive Director of the Office of Strategic Initiatives, which means she's responsible for a heck of a lot of university-wide projects, including OU Now and OU Bound. She's also the Project Manager for the OU Innovation Hub. Meantime, Chris is the Managing Director of the Learning Spaces team at OUIT, which he describes is focused on bringing technologies to OU that enhance student learning without irritating faculty like you. So, Erin and Chris, the stage is yours. Thank you.
How do I know if I'm on?
Try it. Mic check. Hi. How are y'all doing?
Hi. We need to pull up our presentation. Sorry. It's okay.
Do you have my email?
It's on my email, yeah.
I'm going to turn this off real quick so no one sees.
My super private email. It is on exchange, yes, thank you.
Leave it to the IT guy to have problems with technology here.
I'm going to pull this up and then you can just make it happen, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, thanks, sorry for that. So we just wanted today to kind of give you a little bit of information about what services and spaces and support are available for active learning on campus. Before we jump into the nuts and bolts of all that, I wanted to kind of give you the what and the why about active learning just real quickly. I'll make sure we get to lunch on time, but I'll back up, I'm not there yet. So the what, I just wanna make sure we're kind of on the same page here. So active learning. So people know about flipped lectures. So think of flipped lecture as the students who are getting all their content outside of class, whether that be videos of lectures or readings, things to that nature. And then they're coming to class and they're doing all their homework in class. So that's the flipped lecture model, right? So that's one end of the spectrum. That's sort of, I'm all in to active learning. I'm not doing any lecture. We're just flipped learning completely. It really is a spectrum. So it can start all the way from someone doing a 15-minute exercise in class based on the content that they're working on. We don't want professors to think, oh my gosh, I have to just start making videos of all my lectures, and it's overwhelming. So I like to start out with, think of it as a spectrum. Anything you're doing to engage students in class as opposed to outside of class is what we would consider active learning. So this is already going on at OU. This has been before we started doing active learning classrooms, which was about 3 years ago. People were doing it despite the spaces they were in, where they couldn't move chairs, and people were trying to get into groups, you know, turning around. They were doing it, and they were doing a great job. So 3 years ago, we started thinking, we need some spaces that are better for this. We need to really give the people who are doing it a space to do it well, and the people who are interested in doing it a space to try it out. So that's where we came up with sort of the beginning of our active learning here at OU. So there are a lot of universities that have been doing this for 10, 15-ish years or more. We've taken all of the good research they've done and kind of apply that here into what we're doing. And there's a lot of research that's been done on active learning, so I just kind of like to point out some of the stats on it, because it really is powerful, and it makes you really think about how this is impacting students. So this was a great study that came out last year. So they found that, this is worded strangely, but 55% more students fail lecture-based courses than classes with at least some active learning. So I have the numbers over here, but I'm going to try to do them by memory. What they said was they had 29,000 students they were looking at over all of these courses. Of that, there were 9,900 students that failed those courses.
Nailed it.
Right?
Yep.
That's how good I am. Of those 9,900 students that failed, if active learning, even some active learning, had been applied in those courses, they extrapolated that 3,500 students would have passed, which is $3.5 million in tuition. So that's powerful. That's great. Go next. Similar kind of study, the test scores measuring the conceptual understanding were roughly twice as high in classes that use some sort of active learning. I like to use kind of my experience, because I think it's similar to people's experience. As a freshman in college, you know, I'm taking chemistry, and I'm learning chemistry, and I'm studying chemistry, and I'm taking physics, and I'm studying physics, and I'm thinking about physics. It's all very compartmentalized, and calculus, I should throw that in, because that one was, as a freshman or as a sophomore, I was never really connecting that information. You know, we have these capstone courses that you take when you're a senior, a junior, and you're starting to really take all the knowledge you learned and integrate it and apply it cross-discipline. We should be doing that at a younger age. We should be starting it as freshmen. You should be learning how to take information from different courses and apply it to different problems so that it really, you're really retaining it. You're really engaged with that information and you understand how it applies to real life. So these are just actually a few interesting points that come up again and again in all of the research and the surveys and just the multitude of information out there. It increases, which this goes to the point I was talking about, it increases studying for meaning rather than recall. So instead of just memorizing these facts, getting it onto the final exam, and then forgetting about it until someday or never remembering again, calculus for me, you remember it. You know how to apply it to actual problems, which is really important. Promotes better study habits, increases textbook reading, and that actually is not just textbook reading. It's all readings outside of class, watching the content outside of class, et cetera. And one of my favorite ones is the increases class attendance. So when you have these groups of students, which we'll talk about a little bit when Chris is talking about space, a lot of times you're in a group for a month. You might be in a group for the entire semester. So if you don't show up, people know. There is a peer pressure to actually come to class. And once the students actually start getting to know each other, they're more inclined to go to class because they know their I call them coworkers because that's what I was thinking of. You know your students in your group, and it's a more engaging, rich experience than if you're sitting, you're kind of sitting in the back, taking a few notes, and you can kind of leave early if you need to. It's a different experience. Okay, we can go. What's next? Okay, so if you haven't noticed, you will at the end of this presentation, OU as an institution and colleges and departments have invested a lot of time and money into these active learning classrooms. In active learning in general. So why? Why have we been doing it? Kind of the overarching goals. As we all know, there's a lot of initiatives at the state level, the governor's office, at the state regents, at OU, to increase retention and increase completion. Tons of research shows students that are engaged, both in and out of class, are retained at a higher rate. So bottom line, we want students to finish, and we want them to not just finish, but go year to year. You know, that freshman to sophomore year, keeping them is really important. So anything we can do to help with that, first of all. Second of all, and this is sort of the spiel I give a lot on active learning, is I, and probably all of you, don't go to work and sit and take notes and sit by yourself and read. But we don't do that. We work in groups. We have to go out and find information. We have to evaluate the information. We have to apply it to problems. We have to work in groups that we may like and we may not like. And that's what we do in the workforce. So we need to be preparing students better for the workforce and giving them those skills so that day one on the job, they're contributing and they're participating in the group and they feel comfortable with those sorts of things. So I think, is the next slide or video?
Yep.
So we have a program called the Risser Fellows, which Chris is gonna talk about in a minute, but this is a video, a quick video, we did on one of our professors who is a Risser Fellow from last semester. And you'll notice I haven't talked about technology at all, and this is the technology teach-in. So here we go with some technology. She is using technology really well in an active learning classroom. And so we'll start with this, and then I'll transition over to Chris.
I'm assistant professor of geology at the University of Oklahoma. I love working in an active learning classroom because...
How does that happen?
I don't know.
I need to do this. There it goes. There it is. Okay. IT guys. Jeez.
I'm Dr. Shannon Doolin. I'm assistant professor of geology at the University of Oklahoma. I love working in an active learning classroom because it really makes the students and the professor more engaged with each other. You have a conversation about the topics that you're discussing as opposed to sort of a professor talking, students listening. This conversation takes place and a lot more learning can be done from that conversation. When students go out, no matter what job they're going to do, they're going to have to work with a lot of different people in a lot of different group settings. I think active learning classrooms prepare them for this and gives them the skills to navigate their professional life in addition to the knowledge that they'll need in their professional development.
I feel like when you're working in a group, you're responsible for not only yourself, but everybody else in the group. And I think that that's similar to what we would be doing in the workforce.
So the Paul Risser Scholarship has helped me incorporate technology into the classroom, but not just that, but into the field. Professors should be ready for what the active learning classroom is going to do to the conversation. Students will be a lot more engaged as opposed to in a traditional learning setting. The technology we found the most helpful are apps that are developed by geologists to understand the orientation of rocks in the field. Usually we use compasses to do that, and we still do that, but now we can use our technology across all platforms in conjunction with the compasses. You literally set the compass and the iPad on a rock, and you can understand the orientation of the beds better than you could maybe just using the compass.
I have noticed students being more engaged with their work using the technology that we're provided.
Students today are technological natives. Even out here in the middle of nowhere when we're doing geology, they expect to have technology with them. And so now we can utilize it in a more meaningful way.
It makes things easier to see and be able to draw things from the field and put it into the classroom.
I think anyone that's thinking about applying for this grant will be utterly surprised at how much it turns the classroom head over heels. Done the students an amazing amount of good, and it's really helped them become better geologists.
So hopefully by now you guys are all pumped up and you're like, yeah, I want to do this. Where can I do it at? Well, as Mark mentioned earlier, luckily we already have a few spaces on campus, and we're going to have several more coming up in the very short term. So this is our current list of active learning, tech-enabled active learning classrooms that are available to you to use. We have Mountains and the Core, which is down at Stevenson 1. That was kind of our first try at this. It's been a catalyst in a lot of ways. We've got the two centrally scheduled spaces in physical sciences. There's a room down in the lower level of Bazelle. And then this spring is going to be a really busy semester for us because we've got four new spaces that are coming along. Two in Adams Hall on the third floor, one on the first floor of Dell Hall Tower, and the Innovation Hub down at Three Partners Place. So plenty of, I would say plenty. There's opportunity for you. We would love to see 60 of these on campus, and maybe someday we will. This is what we have to work with now. So when we think about these spaces, we kind of think about them on a spectrum. And we've done about a dozen now. And strangely enough, we haven't done a single one the same as another one. And so in my field, in IT, we really focus on standardization. And so it's been kind of weird because these active learning classrooms are all kind of unique in their own way. And so we've started thinking about the way they end up being designed. And it's kind of on the spectrum where on one end, you've got a very high-tech class where you've got all the bells and whistles, all the equipment. And then on the other end, you've got something that's very, very flexible. Everything moves around. Everything can be reconfigured. It's kind of hard to do them both at the same time. And so we found that there's really this spectrum. And the rooms that we have are spread all across that spectrum. And so our rooms that are high-tech focused, you'll notice we've got lots of displays. Obviously, the space is very collaborative. All the students are facing each other. In these examples, we've got round tables or oval tables. And so in a high-tech space, you guys will appreciate this. You like multimedia. These are designed to share multimedia. And so from practically anywhere in this room. You can plug in a device, and you can share your content from that device to a single display in the space, all the displays in the space. You know, your mind is the limit with what you can do. We also have what I like to call the bells and the whistles of video conferencing, recording, wireless video through Apple TVs, sound reinforcement. It's kind of funny. If you get 60 kids in a room and they're all talking, it's hard for them to hear each other. And so we've got microphones, interactive displays, you name it. These are the types of spaces where we like to throw that stuff in there and see what you can do with it. So then on the other end of the spectrum, we've got the maximum flexibility spaces. And you'll see that it's a little simpler. There's still the collaborative tables. There's still the displays on the wall. But things aren't as integrated in here, and there's not as many of those bells and whistles. We really try to focus on what's really important. And what's really important is giving students a space to collaborate, a space to work on their content. The walls, 360-degree writing surfaces in this space. All of the furniture is on wheels. The entire space can be reconfigured in a matter of minutes. And nothing is tied down. So, you know, in the high-tech spaces, we often have to integrate wiring and touch screens and internet and things into the different pieces of furniture. And in a space like this, you just move it all around, you're not going to break anything. So, and then in the middle of the spectrum is where we try to find this happy balance, where you've got a lot of the technology, but you still have a lot of the flexibility. So we've got a little bit of everything around here, and I expect that to continue. So now I hope you're all thinking, yes, I know where I can do this. I want to do it. Sign me up. Well, here's your chance. Here in a couple weeks, this will probably go to your junk email folder. So make sure that you check your junk email folder. Look for an email that looks something like this. We're accepting reservations to teach in the schedulable classes for this coming spring and for the following fall. So submit your reservation. And as Erin mentioned, we have the Paul G. Risser Innovative Teaching Fellowship. Dr. Risser was really fundamental in helping us bring the core to campus. And so in his memory and honor, through help from Mark and Office of Strategic Initiatives and OUIT, we put together the Innovative Teaching Fellowship. And so faculty that are selected for this are given a stipend. They're given personal one-on-one coaching with somebody that's way better at active learning than I am. Right now we're using a faculty member from the University of Minnesota, which is where that's where we got sold on this concept. And so we've brought one of them down. He works one-on-one with the faculty. And the whole thought is that, you know, we want to give you the resources to help transform your course into this new style of learning. Because it's a big step. I mean, this is really, for some people, this is a paradigm shift in the way you teach, and so it takes a lot of support, and we don't want you to think that you have to go out there and do all this on your own. So whether it's logistics, technology, pedagogy, know that we're here to help, and just reach out, and we're happy to do anything we can to make you successful. Questions?
Just looking at the information online, not all of the classrooms are there yet.
Not yet. The ones that are on there are the ones that are currently schedulable. The three that we were talking about are still being constructed, so they're not quite on there yet. We don't have pictures or anything like that, but they will be on there.
And I think the one of the changes, so one of the big changes that came out from discussions this spring is that now almost all of the active learning spaces will now be scheduled through one place, so you don't have to go multiple places. And so there's going to be a person in strategic initiatives that'll be handling all of that, so that's going to really help. And one of the other things to think about is don't try and think about, do I need flexible, do I need tech flexible or tech? You tell us how you're going to teach, and then we'll try and get you into the best space for you.
So this is outside classroom management, scheduling classrooms?
No, not really. So it's going to be pulled through.
Okay.
Okay, so it's going to be pulled through. And then in my role in Packer, I work closely with classroom management. So what will happen is once the three of us agree on the classroom, we'll go to classroom management. And so these spaces are, what we're finding, right, is that if you want to be in these spaces, you love it. And if you're not supposed to be in those spaces, you hate it. And And so we want to make sure the right people get in the right spaces and that we don't fill in. And so we've had an over demand for all of our spaces. So we've been able to fill those up with people that want to try active engagement. So it's not outside of classroom management, it's just a subset.
What if there are a group of faculty here that are interested in this and want to consider adding an active learning classroom to Gaylord? What's the process?
That is a fantastic question.
Thanks, Erin. They should get in touch with us because that's actually one of the things that we kind of do a lot is consult with colleges who are thinking about colleges or departments who are thinking about having rooms like this because we have a lot of resources available to us, and I've done a lot of research on what works, what doesn't work, because as we've done these, as Chris said, they're all a little bit different, and as we've gone through this process, we can use what we've learned for those to say, people liked this, people did not like this, here's why they liked it, things like that. So good question. That would be just email us, and we'll get all the stuff set up.
And we also love to show these spaces off, and so maybe you just want to see one up close and in the wild. We'd be happy to show it to you, give you a demonstration of how it works, talk about some of the different intricacies in each of the spaces too. So just let us know.
All right.
Any other questions?
Cool. Thank you all.
Thanks.
If not, thanks to Erin and Chris and Mark. Okay, now it's time to go to lunch. Go out this door, make two quick lefts, and then down the hall on the right, we'll have lunch, and then hear from our luncheon speaker.
They're good, sir. Good.
I came in short.
Thanks, Ralph.
Hey, thank you.